the Zoning Board of Appeals. Welcome, everybody. Glad you could make it. Nice full house. And I would ask that everybody sign in up there that's here, so that the town keeps a record of who's attended this meeting and who makes comments when we get to the public portion of it. I appreciate that. We opened up, this is the second meeting of this particular case. This is for a comprehensive permit, 40B, called Reading Village, down at the, for the lack of a better word, the Doucette property at Prescott and Lincoln. We have got some peer reviews in already on this, and those have been forwarded to the applicant. So this is a process that we will be going back and forth with our concerns, the town's concerns, abutters' concerns, etc., to the applicant, and he will be addressing those. I think I mentioned the last meeting that the board actually has 180 days from the opening of the permit application, which was last month, I believe February 4th it was. On that. So this will extend for quite a long time, unless we ask for an extension too, or we ask the applicant if he's willing to give an extension, if we're, you know, to negotiate and to meet in the middle here, hopefully, and everybody is happy with it. So that's kind of a brief overview of what we have. People can find all the public information online. On the Reading Municipal website, the town has put all the letters, the peer reviews are on there, letters, concerns from abutters, etc. Everything is online there, so you can review those. The agenda for the meeting tonight is we're going to give the applicant a brief amount of time here to open up and tell us where he has progressed since the last meeting, and then peer reviewers that the town has hired to review the project will give their presentations. The applicant will have a chance to respond and present any additional information that he may have. We'll have questions, discussions by board members, and then there'll be a public comment period and discussion of the next steps and the next hearing day. And hopefully we can move this along tonight so that we're not here too late. During the public comment period, if I can ask everybody in the audience, only speak when called upon. There'll be a microphone going around. State your name and street address for the record. Face and address the ZBA when speaking on that. Be respectful and stay clear of any personal attacks or anything such as that, certainly. And please, no shouting or clapping or any other demonstrations to be tolerated. Again, this goes back to the last comment. Please be respectful on this. The applicant has a job to do, we have a job to do, and we realize the abutters have a job to do, too. With that, as I said, this is a continuation of the public hearing for on the petition of MKM Reading, LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 77 units of rental housing on a 36,064-square-foot residentially zoned tract of land under Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 40B, Sections 20 through 23, with certain waivers from zoning requirements on the property located at 39 to 41 Lincoln Street and 2 to 12 Prescott Street in Reading. And with that, I will ask Matt if you would like to give us a brief rundown on what's happened since the last meeting, and then we can go to the peer reviews.
Thank you, Chair, members of the Zoning Board. It's Matt Zucker from Okay, ready. It's really great to see this more people here tonight than our first meeting. It's a process, and having everyone here is a way to get comments from everyone, and it's healthy to the process to see everyone here, and I would encourage everybody to continue to come to all the meetings. What we've been doing is really listening. We had our last hearing. We met with the selectmen in the interim. We had a design review meeting. We've actually met with some of our direct abutters too, and we're kind of gathering, we've gotten a ton of emails from residents of town. So we're gathering all that information. I'll be brief because we'll get into the peer review consultants. We'll make some design changes between this hearing and the next hearing. So some stuff and details are kind of moot at this point, and some are relevant, but we're more than happy to answer any questions and comments to the best of our ability tonight. We have all our consultants here to talk about that. I've got some additional data that we may get into later about density of the properties and parking ratios of other properties. With that said, we have seen the peer review consultant report, and we continue to work with the town and get comments from all of you and from town departments. And I would imagine that the next meeting will have something to actually present you and have some design changes. But with that said,
okay, thank you. Let's see, we do have some peer reviewers now that would, I understand, give a presentation. Gene, is there any particular order on this?
Yes, we're going to have the architect go first.
Okay.
And then the two engineers will follow.
Okay, any particular order on the engineers, Green or Nitch?
Nitch is going to go second, and then Green
okay.
go third.
Sounds good. Okay, is... The TBA architects here. Okay. Thank you. Floor is yours.
Yeah, my name is Russell Felder. I'm the principal of TBA architect. And Sarah Phillips here from our office. And we'll go through a report that we prepared to have. Some of you had a chance to look at it. I've been online, but I just wanted to take folks through our principal findings and observations. So starting out, this is...
Russell, I'm sorry. Let me give you this.
I can hear you fine. Is there anybody that's having a problem hearing this gentleman?
TV light, yes.
Oh, okay, we'll wait.
Oh, shit. It says the battery's dead. I'll work on that.
Okay, technical difficulties. Go ahead.
Okay, I'll do my best.
Yeah, if you would.
I won't wear out before the end of the presentation here. But starting out with an aerial of the site itself, we do observe that this is a site that's well connected to public transit. I'm sure you folks know exactly where this is relative to the train station and some of the commerce that's above on the other side. And we do observe that this is a good site for the kind of use that's being contemplated. Multifamily housing here, where there is so close to public transit and so close to commercial activity, is a good place to put a lot of people. That said, the density that's proposed at 92.41 units an acre is high, and we'll go into that a little bit more in a few minutes. Relative to the scale of the project, we've tried to combine a couple of things here as we show this, but these are two of the elevations that are the proposed project, and we wanted to relate it to the plan of the building. It's turned upside down, and we'll sort of reorient at different times, but it's perhaps useful to consider here. This one, we do want to make initial observations about the elevations of the building. We do consider that the elevations are handsomely drawn, and they have some interesting characteristics that we'll talk about a little bit later in terms of architectural treatment. But we do observe that they don't really accurately represent the project on several important in several important ways. One of the reasons that we position these elevations here is to relate it to the building itself. And as you see, in a sense, each one of these elevations relates to a portion of the building. And if you look at the elevations, you think you're seeing the whole project, but in fact, you're seeing much less than that. And that if this were a projection, looking straight on from Prescott Street here, the building itself continues and continues to the second structure here, so that there would be more visible building that would continue almost twice the length that this particular building shows. So if you were to picture the whole structure, it would be much larger than it appears in these drawings. At 63 feet, which is about the height of the ridges at the top, it is substantially higher than any other building in the area. The mill building that it's replacing is about 45 feet, that's plus or minus a bit. So that's pretty close to the eave height. Oh yeah, this shows the building there now. The eave of the roofs on the elevation is about that height. Other reference points, the train station is about 22 feet in height, and most of the private homes are about 35 feet at the ridge. So this at 63 feet is a good deal higher than that. We do observe that, and we'll be able to talk about this again in a little bit more detail, but as many of you understand, the building is proposed to occupy the area that the mill is, and also the area fronting Lincoln, and that the gas station parcel in the center of the space, the corner parcel, is not included in that. We frankly wish it were. We think the building would be much more reasonably organized and more efficiently organized if it did take the corner. And it might provide an opportunity to step down a little bit towards the residential side. And although it's fair to say that this street has, for decades, had a very, very large overscale building right there, this is an opportunity to perhaps improve the streetscape as well as enlarge upon it. And so we encourage that to be thought about. This is the shadow study that was part of the proponent's initial presentation. And one thing we observe is that it shows time from 10 a.m. to 2:30 p.m., which is 4.5 hours of the day. And the day, of course, as the sun rises and as the sun sets, is when the shadows are really cast in greater length. This is accurate as shadows are shown, but we do observe that even as it is at this stage, the corner parcel is almost always in shadow. That'd be another reason if we could only have that parcel to be a part of it, so that you wouldn't have that corner lost. The sun is going to be lost to that for a good part of the day. We would also be interested to see both earlier and later hours of the day to be a more complete representation of that. We also observe in the plan, you can see this, and we'll get and talk about this a little more, there's very little or effectively no open space on the site. They're building this building right to the perimeter, and that is not consistent with existing residential patterns, and it does create other operational concerns that we'll speak to. We have some questions about the roof configuration, which is shown here in sort of model form. And we're not exactly sure how the two buildings connect. They are referred to, in a sense, as two different buildings, but they're linked together, and internally they circulate as one building. So we weren't really clear on how the roof worked in that regard. So it's more a question than a concern. And we talked about the gas station parcel. So I'm going to move on to the next roof plan. Now, this is the roof plan of the proposal. And one thing you'd like to observe, you'll see here the dotted line, which relates to the walls of the building itself. And the roof goes beyond it. There are overhangs that are about 5 feet, it looks like, that goes beyond it. You can see that in the next section as well, where this is a building section they've shown, and you can see how the roof extends beyond the wall. This is a little hard to read, I think, as a drawing, because the way the designer has worked it, the sloped roof that runs along to the top of the ceiling actually continues to that eave there. You see it more in the faint elevation behind it. So you do get that big, long roof with the overhanging eaves and the brackets that you can see in the corner, and they're sort of a design characteristic there, which we'll talk about a little more. We do want to illustrate the way the walls and the eaves work, and also want to point out just in passing, and we'll talk about this a little more, but you'll observe some columns that are shown supporting the building that's up in the air, really, because the ground floor is all parking, or effectively all parking. Okay, now, on to the next. This is the civil drawing. And the civil drawing, notice the property lines as they're shown configured around the building. We draw your particular attention to running along Prescott Street, how the building walls really come right up to the property line. In other places, the building walls come very, very close to the property line. Remember that eave that overhangs. So the upper section of the roof actually goes beyond the walls. So to the extent that these plans are showing building wall construction to the property line, the roof is actually going beyond the property line. Along Prescott Street, it covers the entire length of the sidewalk. In other portions of the property, it extends over other people's property. This isn't. You can't do that. So that is a concern. It would require either changing the design so you don't have the overhang, or stepping the walls back, which would have a major impact on the organization of the parking and the building itself, which is very tightly planned. As you can see here, the parking is extremely tightly configured. The next plan is the, well, I guess this is just an enlargement of that. Okay, this is now, one thing we would like to observe, we didn't have a chance to talk about it. This is the civil plan. We mentioned that the concern about the site borders and boundaries. Another issue that we see here, and a concern that we have, if you recall that site section, or the building section, the first floor is almost entirely parking, and all of the building itself, which goes, this is the edge of the building right here, running along. So it's about 7-8 feet back from the back property line, and continues here around and then up, right up to the edge there. So parking actually goes beyond the building dimensions, but only slightly, and for the most part, the entire parking area is under the structure itself. As near as we could tell, the actual dimensions weren't presented, but there's probably about 9 foot clear space from the first floor is shown at 10.5 feet up above grade. So you have a foot and a half for all the structure, and you need a very robust structure between the parking and the occupancy, because residential separation from parking requires concrete 2-hour fire ratings. It's got to be very sturdy, so it's thick. And so if you assume that there's a foot or a foot and a half of structure there, let's say there's 9 foot clear, that is insufficient for fire trucks, any kind of service vehicles. So in effect, you cannot really have garbage collection or fire access to any portion of the building, only around the perimeter of the site. And that is a concern that we observe. We also see this as being a problem for trash collection, because if you can't pull off-site, then you're having a trash collection take place on the street. And that's definitely a quality issue with 77 apartments, which is what's proposed. There's a fair amount of trash that's being collected, and that is, if the trucks have to pull it, you know, alongside Prescott's order to move in and out, that would seem to be a problem. We also observe here that because so much of the area is paved and then behind structure, and there's so little open space, there's no place to put snow. So in the middle of the winter, where, you know, this is open, to the sky. So in this area here, snow would drop. You'd have to be able to remove that. And again, with 9-foot height, it becomes pretty difficult for trucks to move it out of that. So that would be an operating concern that we would have. So relative to that, I mean, there are things you can do. Of course, you can raise the building a little higher, and that would make more access to other kinds of traffic. And you can also establish some open space on the site, which might solve that problem. And of course, including the corner parcel, again, as we spoke of, would really facilitate a lot of the site organization and maybe even make it with some open space on the site. Relative to materials, again, the next, this is one of the elevations. As I mentioned before, we do think the building is nicely rendered. It has kind of an architectural, sort of a late Victorian residential feel about it, with wood brackets, or I should say just brackets at the eaves, overhangs on the roof, some nice mix of materials on the first floor and the upper floors. So we think it's well treated, but again, the imagery is a little deceiving about how large the building would appear. It also has some inconsistencies operationally. If there is this long eave, then the building has to be smaller, and how does that work? If you cut those eaves off, which is a simple thing to do, radically changes the appearance of the building. Let's see, other things, an observation, and not to suggest that this is the case here, but as you look at it, it has the feeling of stone and masonry on the first floor, perhaps clapboard or other kinds of wood treatment on the upper floors, double hung windows, those that gable, sort of gable treatment, the dormer treatment, and the brackets allude to a type of construction which 100 years ago would have been in wood and stone. Nowadays, it's very expensive to do things in just that way. So there are other materials that wind up being the kinds of things that people of necessity employ in their construction now. And so the concern that we have, and this is only an observation for the future more than the present, is that if you wind up with substituting a masonry tile, which is a quarter inch thick, applied to a surface instead of a masonry wall, that's very less durable. Roof materials that may or may not be, frankly, it's difficult to find wood that's wood anymore. I mean, if you guys have houses, you know, you buy some wood, you paint it, and peel the paint off because the wood has grown in 5 years instead of 50. So it's very hard to find the kinds of materials that once worked quite well. So as a consequence, it's a challenge and appropriate for future reviews to consider the kinds of materials that this will continue to sort of look as good as it is here. On to the next topic, utility and service vehicles we mentioned. I want to just treat this in a little more detail. You notice here that in the civil drawing, the curb, as shown, the proposed curb for Prescott Street, alongside the one area that we see that is open space, that runs along the back of the gas station and up to Prescott, would seem to be the one place that one could store trash and have trash pickups. There may be an opportunity to pull off street there, but your own requirements for the amount of area that is dedicated to trash storage and pickup would be very difficult to achieve in that amount of space. And I do observe that this is, well, actually it's called the money corner, if you know what I mean. That corner between Prescott and Lincoln Street is how the building presents itself. And where you have this gas station in the middle and all of the trash and service right behind it, with the train station across the street, this isn't necessarily the nicest presentation to the corner. So we just observe that. One thing we are concerned about is there is no drop-off or pickup area here. Again, it's at the curb. This right here is the entrance to the building. And so if someone were to come and need to be picked up or a cab, then the cab will need to stop on the street and, in effect, obstruct traffic 77 units, that's a lot of people. There's some activity that is possible. There are people moving in and out, moving trucks. You know, if you can't necessarily drive under a 9-foot parking area. So again, the same problem. You could find a lot of impact on Prescott Street just operationally with the building. Another issue or concern that we have, you'll notice this is the civil drawing, and this civil drawing indicates 78 parking spaces. The written proposal and the architectural plan shows 83 parking spaces. There are some differences. You'll note here how this has been dealt with because of the necessary dimensions. It's extremely tight as a parking configuration. And if I think we have the parking, the architectural one right next to it. You'll see here there are some other spaces that were thought about. But of course, when things are carefully engineered, it gets tighter and tighter. As a consequence, we tend to think that the engineering drawing is a more accurate representation. So that provides 78 parking spaces as proposed for 77 units. In effect, there's no visitor parking here. Also, this plan indicates two handicap spaces up by the entrance. There are four handicap units in the building, and there would need to be four handicap spaces for those units. Those are a little wider and therefore take a little more room. Everything has an impact that could, again, start reducing parking. One of the other issues here is that neither the architectural or the civil drawings indicate the structure of the building as it comes to ground. If you look here, what it shows is the walls that flank the entire perimeter in the dark line. And then you see the dotted line of the structure itself. So this entire length here, for example, which is 190 feet, the building is hanging out, and when it's parking, under sort of partially in, partially out. We can't speak to the solution, but I would be very surprised if there weren't a series of columns that would be placed running along here to hold the building up. There will also be columns on the interior of the structure to support the building. Columns will decrease the efficiency of the parking. If the column lands, even if it's perfectly positioned, it has a thickness. It has to be surrounded. So all of a sudden, you'll lose one or two spaces running along this great length here. You may lose a couple of others because of interior columns. We can't say about that. But we do observe that at 78 spaces, even that is difficult to achieve. And that raises an issue in terms of the ratio of units to parking. And then another question, I guess, about that is the, as we spoke before about the overhang and the curb, we do notice this is, the dotted line here is the property line. And so the next picture, I think, will illustrate blocks of the two of these there. This, again, is a civil drawing. Being more precise, you see that it's about a foot off of the property line from the look of it, or perhaps even less. And I draw your attention to these other spots here that are very close, which we'll talk about a little more. If we go to the next shot, I guess that is, we're back. I think the thought was that here's where I was going to remind you that this overhang is there, but I think that we can move on. This is just a picture of some of the existing right now. There are 8 cars that are parked alongside the mill. You notice there is a sidewalk. It's hard to see from a distance, perhaps, but there's a sidewalk here. There's a little foot and a half of planting there, or planting, just dirt that things are growing in, but a little bit of greenery. It's nice. And then you've got the 5-foot.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman. Would you mind using a pointer, please?
All right, it's great. Thank you. I appreciate that. Okay. There is the sidewalk. And right at that point right there, notice, is sort of a break where the tires are, the parked cars are running right alongside the street itself. If you see here, you notice the curb. This is an existing curb, and it's a little off the screen, but there is a curb that exists at the corner here. So this curb is now being proposed to be extended all the way around and then forming a curb running here. That that curb is there. In other words, if this street width is what you're all used to having passage in, you cannot have any cars any longer parked in front of this building, because the curb is being brought right out to where those cars have sort of pulled themselves up and over. So in that regard, we see that there are 77 units being brought into the community. There is what's supposed to be 78 parking spaces that maybe we might lose a couple, and then there are 8 parking spaces that will be have to be taken away in order to be able to keep the building functioning. So there's a net loss to the neighborhood of parking, and despite the presence of this additional housing. The next topic is egress and safety in the building itself. This is the plan of the first floor, residential floor of the building. And you notice this is the sort of connection between one major building here and the other structure here. This courtyard is where that big long 190 running feet of unsupported structure is, and the cars are coming right along here underneath. Some of what we observe about this is, I apologize in advance, this is a little difficult to explain. Notice that there are 3 egress stairs, one here, and one over here. And those of you who are used to looking at building plans, you can see that every one of these, there you have a stair, you have a corridor that comes to a door, and the door opens to a stair landing which goes down half a flight, and then down half a flight again. So it returns halfway down and then down to the first floor. That is to say that in each one of these, you have the corridor exiting to a stair that then exits again out in the same direction. Now I think if this would be the time to talk about the next. This is the ground floor level. And you see here that each of these stairs are shown with egress doors on the outside of the building. But recall, the only way these stairs work is you have a corridor, a door here, that in this case goes up to the next floor and out to the corridor, goes up to the next floor and out to the corridor. So you're half a flight up on all of the outside platforms. You're 5 feet up in the air. So the door certainly cannot step out into that. The way that, of course, you can make that work is to put a platform and stairs running out. There is a provision of the Mass Building Code which says that emergency egress exits must be no less than 10 feet from a property line. So you could build a construction here to safely get somebody past, but it would not be code compliant because this is less than 10 feet away from the property line. This is less than 10 feet away from the property line. So these things would need to change. They would absolutely need to change. That's not to say they can't, and folks are creative about this, but again, our job is to observe current conditions and just identify the possible concerns. We also note that there are 3 exits. We mentioned this 1, 2, 3. One of the things that confuses us, and I think from a building code standpoint we need clarity on, is there is a reference to building A and building B as if they were 2 buildings. If there were 2 buildings, you would need a second stair, because each building needs 2 stairs. If we go back to one of the floor plans, I guess I'm not sure we have. Yeah, this is good. You'll see here that this works. If somebody has an apartment here, they can go down the stair and out, or they can come along and through to the next building, come along and through and down, and then out to the next stair. And folks here have a stair here, they have a stair here, and of course they could also make that 3rd stair out. This is the elevator. And so we do observe that that needs clarification is all. Is it 2 buildings, is it 1 building? And in fact, the question that we have generally is what it looks like here. The elevations, as we showed you earlier, don't go to that portion of the building, so we don't really see what that looks like. We do also observe 1 elevator. We're concerned about that. 77 units on 4 floors. One elevator would not meet performance standards. There's no building code that says you can't do it, but there are engineering standards for speed of movement and frequency of door opening and how long you have to wait, and this would, folks would be very hard-pressed to be satisfied with one elevator in this regard. The second elevator solves that. Something else we observe about the elevators, by the way, this elevator right here is shown very close to the roof edge, and so the penthouse of the elevator would be sticking up through the roof. That isn't shown in the elevations. You might be able to avoid that with a hydraulic elevator. The hydraulic elevator is slower than a hoist elevator. That would sort of exacerbate the other problem of one elevator serving all these folks. So we might suggest that they add another elevator, and maybe if there were two separate buildings, that would be one way to place it in the other building. Some other observations I would make about the program as it's proposed. The main entry, actually, I guess on the first floor, which is the port plant down below, this is the main entry for all 77 units. We consider it to be very small. Even post boxes would have a hard, you'd be hard pressed to fit them in that space. And we would encourage the designers to create a little bit more common space. And in fact, our observation generally about the project is that there is not a lot of common space in the building. The major thing that there is the courtyard, which is a generous space. There are no public meeting spaces. There are no common facilities. For example, the courtyard here, we observe, it's hard. The common spaces, these are very tight spaces. They're the corridor itself, you come out and then you turn, take a left or take a right and then a left, or then you go straight. So finding the courtyard might be a challenge, and you notice that there are no public restrooms associated with that. So if anybody's using it, they really have to make a beeline to their apartments. And some of these corridors are some distance. So I guess everybody would just be prepared. Let's see, other things. Corridors, the law I mentioned. We also have some concerns about the impact of the courtyard on the next-door neighbors. The courtyard is at within 5 feet or so of the property line. You're a story up at this point, looking into the backyards of all the abutters right back there, so it certainly has an impact on those residents. Relative to accessibility, discovered one error in our report, which we'd like to make mention of right now. We misread the exact number, actually going to the proposal here. This is where the 77 units is the total amount that's proposed. There are four accessible units in here. Our report, we're looking at the plans and not the table, and so we only saw 30. So there are four, that's the correct number. Relative to affordability, there are 19 units that are affordable, which are 24.6% of the number of 77. And although 24.6 is close, it is not 25. And you are not allowed to round down, or round up in this case. There are different aspects to Chapter 40B, the law that all of this is being submitted on the basis of. And you aren't necessarily restricted to 25% as a threshold. For example, depending on the income level that is required, you can have as few as 20% of the units. But we do observe that at least on the sort of classic basis of what you would think, this particular program would require a 20th. You're right now 19 affordable units proposed, and so we would say 20 would get you over 25% if 77 units were the final number. Generally, though, we do find that the apartments themselves are well designed. We don't have a lot of comments on them. There's some little marginal things about handicapped access, which would be ironed out in subsequent phases in any case, but we don't really see the need to offer particular observations about it. The units are reasonable. I think people would enjoy having them in apartments. We do have one reference project that we wanted to make mention of, which is just around the corner on Street 3052, as I'm sure all of you know it. There are two things about this project we want to offer by way of comparison. One is this project uses the first floor for commercial, which we think is a great thing to do. When you are at a street opposite a train station, first floor commercial is part of what sort of creates a town center and reinforces that. We encourage that mixed use to be considered here, as opposed to 100% residential. We also observed that this particular project is 77 units an acre, and as I mentioned before, the proposed number is 92.4. So that's materially larger density than this project. That's a summary. Certainly, if there are any questions, I'm not sure if you want to proceed directly to the next vote.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. And I think you made some good points there. I'll just point out again, this is on the town website, the letter from the architect, and if anybody is interested in going to the town website, you can see that in there. And I know the way this process works, that the applicant, or the developer, will respond to these comments that you've heard the architect tonight bring up. And these are certainly valid points. That's why we have a peer review. This is an architect that's looking at another architect's work, and he has questions, and we'll get these questions answered, certainly. Okay, appreciate it. John?
Does anybody want to take the magic pointer?
You can leave it over. You can leave it right.
We're just getting the cord for that, so if you can just give us one quick second.
I'm getting nervous.
You can leave that. Oh, the mouse?
You can leave it.
Yes, you can leave it right here, and we'll make sure he gets it.
To the next presenter.
I had a question for the where'd you go? Oh, Russell.
We're going to hold all the questions till after all the peers, John, unless you have...
There was two things that I thought that there was in there that hadn't been mentioned. So.
I'd like to get through all the peers, and then we'll do it. So, Pete, note your questions, and then we'll have our comments to the board, and we can ask them.
Well, it's not a comment, it's a question for the architect.
Well, you can ask it then, okay, at the end And I think it'll just facilitate the whole process moving along quickly. This will be Niche Engineering?
Yes.
Okay, this is the engineer's peer review right now.
Hello, everybody. I'm Matt Burchard from Niche Engineering. We did a civil engineering peer review of the site plan. A lot of comments that we had, not a lot, several of them were already heard by the architectural presentation, so in the interest of kind of speeding things up, I'm trying to skip over those. And on some of the comments that might be a little bit of a technical nature, I'm probably not going to elaborate on too much, and if people have questions about those specific items, I can provide further detail on things that aren't clear in the question and answer. So I'm probably going to kind of cruise through those a little bit quickly as well.
Would you like us to bring you one several times?
Yes, if you can mind, that'd be great.
Yep.
Thanks. So relative to
I offer, but she doesn't.
Compliance, parking, and access, and grades. Again, some of these comments were already covered. One of the comments relating to parking space provision. There is a loading space requirement in the zoning code. For this size project, the code require two loading spaces. They're not shown on the drawings, and the applicant has not requested a waiver from that requirement. If the project entry areas, and again, some of these comments also are probably a result of the fact that these are preliminary drawings and may be fleshed out in later drawing phases, but at the project entries here on Lincoln Street and on Prescott Street, there really isn't any detail showing how those entrances interact with the existing public sidewalks. So we would suggest that more detailed information on those access points were provided in the final drawings. The parking limit, and this was kind of alluded to during the architectural presentation as well, but the parking edge along the property line on the south side of the project site directly abuts several residential properties, and there isn't any indication on the plans of whether or not there's any screening for those lots up against the line, you know, some kind of screening fencing, some other way of preventing headlight glare from affecting the abutting properties. There also wasn't any information on the drawings relating to site lighting, locations or type, and we would recommend that information be provided to the town in terms of illumination and location of lighting fixtures. One of the comments that was also mentioned during the architectural presentation relates to the presence of potential roof extension over the public way along Prescott Street. And one potential issue that should be addressed by the applicant would be the prevention of snow and ice moving off of that roof onto the public walk and public way. Let's see. And it doesn't show on this page, but the drawings indicate some preliminary site grading across the property. One of the issues that we noted was that the spot grading design that was shown on the interior portion of the lot for the car in the park, although it's not open to the weather, had really minimal slopes to it, and we feel that they're insufficient to provide adequate drainage of that area in the building, so that would need to be addressed. There are a couple of minor issues related to this sediment and erosion control, which I think we can probably skip over. But in terms of the site utility systems, there was no information provided in the application relating to sanitary sewage or peak water and fire demands presented by the project. In order for us to comment on the potential impact of the project on the municipal systems, that information should be provided, as well as the applicant's opinion of project impacts to those systems. There wasn't any indication of power and telecommunication services proposed for the building, and we just are curious as to whether or not a transformer would be required for the project, and if so, where it would be located on the plans. There's a little bit of a lack of information on the drawings for existing and proposed utility service connections. Again, I think they were shown in a preliminary manner, and then a lot of that stuff will be provided in the final plans. But in order for us to comment on the feasibility of those connections, we would need to see that information added. Okay, so the way the applicant proposes to drain the pavement under and around the building. Essentially, the entire area under here drains to a catch basin located in this corner and connects into the municipal system. They also have an infiltration system under each building that is intended to collect roof runoff. One issue that they should address by confirming whether or not the building would be that the underground, the surface parking would be classified as a residential garage. Typically, projects like this that we've seen in the past are classified that way under the building code, and as such, there are different regulations that are associated with collection of water that accumulates under the building. It has to be directed into certain systems and connected to the sanitary sewer system versus being recharged into the ground. So that would need to be clarified under a later submission as to whether or not they're compliant. And there are a few things associated with the stormwater runoff calculation package that was provided. It's a little bit technical. I think we can probably skip over a lot of the details. But there were certain aspects that we thought were incomplete or could have been presented in a different way in terms of runoff direction and collection and pre and post development analysis and comparison of runoff flows. And we can talk about that in more detail if anyone has questions about that. And that's really about it. There were some other issues directly related to the stormwater package, but I think they're not necessarily worth going into in detail. So I think that's really the bulk of the conversation.
Okay. Thank you so much. And again, this is a peer review on the engineering. You will find that letter on the town website.
Chair, we're just dealing with a battery issue. So
sure. Now, is this for the microphone, too? Is that going to be...
No, the microphone, we have a battery problem. And okay. We have the... trying to get it back into the plug-in mode.
Okay.
There we go.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, we're good.
Okay, this will be the gentleman from Green International.
Yes.
On the traffic review. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jason Sobel. I'm a transportation engineer from Green International. And we reviewed the traffic study that was submitted as part of this application, as well as the site plans as they relate specifically to traffic and parking. A few of my points were also covered by the previous peer reviewers as well, some of the parking stuff there. So I may go a little quickly through those, but there are some additional parking points I'd like to make. One other point, since we submitted our peer review letter to the town a week ago, yesterday we received a response from Vinas to several of our comments. So we have some additional information that I didn't have at the time that I completed my peer review. So there's some new info there, but there's also several of the responses were, we will provide additional information down the road. So we still don't yet have all the info that we'd like to see. So when we reviewed the traffic study, maybe just back to the aerial photo to begin with. Sure. That looks great. So we reviewed the traffic study. One of the first things we looked at was the study area that they did for the traffic study, which really consisted of three intersections, Prescott at Lincoln, Prescott at Washington, and Washington at Lincoln Street here in Minot. We generally thought the study area was appropriate and fine for the size of the project being proposed here, and we didn't really have issues with that. We also reviewed the crash analyses that the applicant had submitted in the traffic study, as well as the general future traffic growth projections in the area without the project. And basically all that was done according to typical industry practices and standards, and we didn't really take issue with any of that. For their trip generation, how much traffic would be going in and out of this proposed site, a total of 41 vehicles in the morning, a total of 60 vehicles during the afternoon peak hour. One thing that we note is that they did not take any credit or reduction of those trips for public transportation. We took a quick look at the census data for the whole town of Reading, and 6% of commuters use public transportation to commute. A site located right across the street from the commuter rail station would presumably be somewhat higher than the town as a whole. So the trip generation estimates here that the applicant presented could be viewed as a worst case scenario, assuming no one is taking public transportation. After the trips are generated, they're distributed onto the roadway network. In our peer review letter, we'd indicated that the trip distribution appeared reasonable, but the applicant hadn't provided the census data and calculations for that. They have since given us that information with their response yesterday, and it seems to be consistent with the distribution that they used. and we have no issues there. So now let's jump, maybe we can go to the site plan itself.
The civil one?
Yeah, keep going. The one with the parking and the dimensions would be great. One more, maybe. Perfect. All right. So there were several recommendations made by the applicant's own traffic engineer for the site. And some of those details either were missed or were not included, or there's going to have to be some revisions. Probably the biggest one from a traffic and circulation perspective, the driveway on Prescott Street is proposed to be a two-way entrance and exit. And on the civil plans, it's 20 feet wide, which is generally too narrow. Again, even the applicant's own traffic engineer recommended that driveway be 24 feet wide. The one-way exit driveway onto Lincoln Street is proposed to be 16 feet wide, and that should be fine for a one-way driveway. Now, if we look at the parking area in this immediate area, it looks to us as if the parking driveway width is restricted a little bit by this very first parking space. It doesn't quite go as deep as the other ones, and I suggest that's really not a great location for a parking space. Either adjustments should be made in that area to allow a full-width driveway, or perhaps that parking space could be removed or moved to a different part of the site, which may also be a challenge given how tightly packed in these parking spaces are. So then there were some other recommendations, such as showing the internal sidewalk connections to the sidewalks that exist today and that will be rebuilt, and some of those additional details that we'd like to see, particularly we'd like to see it really with any project, but particularly a project such as this right across from the commuter rail. Certainly, the project should be built in such a way to encourage as much walking and biking and other means of transportation, to encourage that as much as possible. So we certainly want to have well-defined, clear connections, either from the park to and from the parking area, to and from the buildings themselves. Let's see. So now we can get to the parking themselves. TBA had indicated a slight discrepancy between what was being requested from the zoning waiver and the plans. By my count, on the civil engineering plans, there's actually a total of 80 spaces. So this is 1.04 spaces per unit, slightly more than one per unit, but still well short of the town's requirement of 1.5 spaces per unit. And that's really going to essentially mean no visitor parking on site. And as a result of that, we've requested two things from the applicant. We've requested an off-street parking study, or an off-site parking study, rather, to really document the total number of parking spaces in the neighborhood, in the area, how they're used, what parking restrictions currently exist, and how well they're utilized throughout the day. Is it totally full? And really have hard numbers to sort of justify if there's going to be 77 new residential units, visitors, guests come over and visit, there's no place for them to park. You know, they really need to be able to justify the use of those off-site parking spaces, and whether or not there's sufficient number. And then in terms of the site itself, we've asked for a comparison or other data to justify that this would be sufficient. As a general reference, the Institute of Transportation Engineers, ITE, has a parking generation manual. And really, it's just an aggregation of data from across the country looking at various land uses and what the peak parking demands are for each of those. So for an apartment building similar to this, and this is getting a little technical here, but the 85th percentile peak parking demand, which means that the peak parking demand is basically 85% of similar sites, is at 1.46 parking spaces per unit. So again, it's technical. It's pretty consistent actually with the town's requirements, which we're going to have. And it certainly raises concerns given the density of this project and the amount of parking that's being provided. So the applicant has, in their peer review response, in response to our comments, they've said that they will be undertaking these studies and providing additional information and additional data, although we haven't seen it yet. Our other comments here was really in terms of off-site mitigation and what might be appropriate here for a project like this. In particular, we focused on pedestrian connections and want people who are living in these buildings here to be able to walk and encourage the walking and not have to use your car at all times. So one of the things that we noted was that this area here, I believe that's 31 Lincoln Street, the Brown's Auto Body, that there's really no sidewalk there today. It's basically just an open driveway. The area here, maybe we can flip to an aerial photo.
They're going to start charging me.
I brought my own couple of slides with aerial photos too, but I figured it'd be simple.
Charging my slides here.
Now let's go maybe one back. Sure. So this area here that is a critical area. Pretty much all the residents who would be walking from the building to the commuter rail would be crossing somewhere in this area here, whether they're coming along Prescott Street or along Lincoln Street. And there's really no wheelchair ramps there to speak of, let alone ADA compliant wheelchair ramps. I think there was one ramp on this side here, which was a very old asphalt ramp, certainly not consistent with current standards. On this corner here, I wouldn't even call it a ramp. It was sort of a sidewalk, and then it just goes down into the dirt, which is a smooth thing, but not what we'd want to see. So in the response that we received from the applicant to our comments, there was an additional commitment from them to reconstruct all these sidewalks in the frontage of the site, as well as in front of this corner site here, assuming sufficient right-of-way and all that is available, because if they don't own the property, that there's not a lot that they can do if it's all private. But I believe that there is a few sufficient right-of-way here to construct a new sidewalk. They also indicated that they'd be working with the town to determine the best location for the crosswalks to get across to the commuter rail. It's hard to see in this photo here, but there's really two crosswalks coming from this corner, one going straight to this parking area, and then a very long crosswalk here that leads to the train station. Certainly, it's atypical and it's not an ideal configuration. But there are challenges given the existing parking that sort of face-in parking, 90-degree parking, right along that building, which is also privately owned. So the options there may be somewhat limited, but it is encouraging that they're willing to not just reconstruct the sidewalks and the wheelchair ramps, but also provide crossing in the best practical location and working with the town to determine exactly what that location would be. So that's really the key points that I like to make.
Okay.
And I guess we'll pass it over to the board now.
Thank you. Okay, those are the, you've heard the peer reviews, the board here. I know the agenda calls, let's see, I don't know if we, John, I know we had some questions here from board members. What's your thoughts? Does the developer need to want to respond to some of these comments in general, or do we want to get our comments in there and let the developer respond?
I wonder how much the developer's going to be able to respond.
Well, that's
today.
It.
Doing the
right. I would assume, too.
He's not sure, a lot I'm sure of that's going to be a fruitful, I mean, certainly right. A public comment.
Yeah, we're just, Matt.
More than happy to give us a general response, but I think that was, you know, the point,
Yeah.
gathering the information and digesting, but.
Okay, I know John had some questions of the couple of the peer reviewers, and but why don't we go in order here? Si, Kathleen, John, Matt, if he has any questions. Matt's a new member for his first meeting tonight. We throw him right into the fire on this. And then David and myself, and we'll go in order. Si, do you have any particular questions, comments that you would like to make in regards to the peer reviews or to the developer?
I'd like to make an observation.
Okay.
Initially, okay. We started this process February 4th with our first public hearing on the zoning board on this issue. And there's been a subsequent Board of Selectmen, a CPDC meeting, and there have been numerous inputs
DLC.
From community. And I share a lot of that concern, but as you get into a detailed review of this application, the most concerning thing to me, which is quite obvious to most everybody, is the density of this project. In fact, an awful lot of stuff in a very small space. Proverbial 10 pounds in a 5-pound bag. And it creates a lot of issues, many of which we're hearing and will continue to hear, and we have to walk through all of them. So my initial comment or question to the developer is, why? Why did you pick a project of this size and of this configuration to put on this lot? And did you consider a smaller density project that might be economically feasible to you and more attractive to the town and the community and everything else? And if you didn't, why did you? And if you did, why did you arrive at something like this? And that's, you know, that's a comment I'd like to just throw out on the table, okay? Because we got a lot of things to walk through here. And we're just hitting the surface of all of this stuff. And we're going to find out that some of these problems can be solved, probably many of them. But I would predict, observe, that some of them won't be solved unless there's some significant changes made to this project. So, you know, it's a 5-story building in a neighborhood community. It's not Somerville, it's not Cambridge, it's not Boston, it's Reading. It's like Stoneham. All we know, okay? It appears like it doesn't fit. And I'm just wondering whether you folks have considered something else smaller than this. I mean, you could make it a 4-story. Maybe the 3-story. I don't know what's best that fits your needs, what's economically feasible, and what fits the need of the town, needs of the town, Reading, and the people living. Okay.
Okay.
So I get up to the question: did you ever consider something other than this size project in the process of arriving to this proposed plan? And if not, why not?
It will lead us into a bigger discussion about density, which we're happy to discuss now or after the board's commented. It's up to the chair.
You get Si's comment. Why don't we go through all our comments and then let him respond to them, because I'm sure some of us may have the same comments.
I just thought I'd start with that.
Right, exactly. Well, thank you, Si. Yeah. Kathleen?
I follow up with the same concern, and I think my biggest observation is my concern about the density, where it is, but I do believe that by reducing the density of this project, it will minimize a lot of the other concerns in terms of the parking, number, the height. All of those issues may go by the wayside somewhat if the density of this project was reduced. And I just think overall that right now is my biggest issue with the number of units you're looking to put in here and the problems that are going to be caused as a result. So again, that's just overall, and I would love an answer to that question that I asked too. So, but for now, that's all.
John.
my questions, I guess, they weren't comments. I wasn't ready to make comments, I don't think, at this point, although Cy brought up a very major question for the developer, why the density. That's something he's going to have to, I think, prove to the rest of us, the board members especially, but also the community and the neighborhood in which the project is going to be built. The questions that I had tonight were, so far, were based upon the peer reviews, and that's the only portion that I want to address right now.
Sure.
So I first go to Russell. I think your report was insightful, complete, extremely well done. Some of the questions I had were on the elevators. Let's go back to the building itself. On the elevators, you mentioned in the report that with one elevator for the two buildings, people who would perhaps need access to elevators because they live in the fifth floor or whatever, to reach the elevator might be a distance of as much as 250 feet to travel to get to the elevator to go from the fifth floor to the first floor. I thought that that may need to come out, although all of this is in the report itself. One area that I thought wasn't brought up, but I thought was extremely important was the actual true elevations or site elevations of the garage itself, its location, perhaps somewhat below level, and then the increase above level where the first floor, actually the second floor would be, second through the fifth floors. And the concern that I would have, because you also mentioned that, but so did engineering mention that, was how do you support these two units, or these two buildings? The question is, as you're looking at that, you don't have a true elevation as to calculating what the actual height is, because there is a technicality about where that elevation starts, or where ground level starts. And engineering mentioned also that when you have a surge in the spring or whatever of water and you're below grade, in essence, where does that water go and what does that do to the ground underneath? But even more so, what does it do to the elevations above ground that you're putting perhaps some landscaping and what up against the walls of the building and so forth? And the question then becomes twofold. One is the safety and the structure of the two buildings, especially the one on Prescott Street. But the question becomes, what is the site view that you have going into, coming out of the parking areas, especially on Prescott Street, but also the one closest to, I guess, Lincoln Street? When you put the plantings there, the elevation is up. When you're looking out the car window, which is only going to accept regular sedans and vans possibly, but no emergency vehicles of the type that we're talking about, which again was mentioned in two of the reports, all of that has to come into effect somewhere down the line. I thought that the numbers of questions that our peer review specialists have asked in their reports would make an extensive list compiled for the developer to come back and answer for us at a future meeting. And I think that is very important, because with all this information just coming to the forefront this evening, we have to, board members definitely, but everybody in the town, especially the abutters, have to address also, is how are those questions answered and what are the results of those? And I think the results of those may be what Cy brought up, and that is that the site just may be too dense with what we need to get through to build something that the town is going to be happy with, but also be able to live with as we go through this process. And there are a number of mass and federal regulations that we have not talked about that were mentioned in these peer reviews that the developer needs to answer also. And I think the only other question that I had was based upon the parking and the travel. You talked about three intersections. There are a number of other intersections that I think are as important. One is the two train crossings, and the other one is the intersection of Main and Washington Street. No matter where you go, unless you're going to take a back door out of Reading, you're going to have to use one of those intersections, and we don't have any information on it. But on your parking within the site, you mentioned that the 24 feet between back-to-back parking areas is minimally. I mean, with some of the bigger SUVs parking there, we don't know what's going to be for vehicles there. You're going to have a hard time backing up and getting out because the 24 feet may not be sufficient. It's minimal, but it's there. I think you did bring up the access on Prescott Street going out, just getting out of the facility. So that's the only concerns that I have that were brought up in the peer reports that I think we need more information.
Okay, John, thank you. Nick, if you would like to bypass, I think we could all see that.
Yeah,
any questions you
I
have?
I don't have any questions or concerns. I look forward to see how the developer answers these questions.
Thank you. David.
As I've mentioned, I just have some commentary and perhaps some recommendations, if I may. I agree and support what the other board members have discussed as it relates to issues that relate to scope and parking, etc. And my major concern here is in the realm of all these reports and peer reports have given a lot of information for the developer, the applicant, to take back to address. Many of those relate to code and statutory issues, which lead me to believe that this project is becoming, the developer has an issue and really needs to address this with abutters, with the town, and that is the concept of becoming a nuisance. And I don't mean that in the vernacular. I don't mean that in the common sense of the word. But as we get into infiltration, drainage studies, overhang studies, encroaching into fencing and screening studies, I bring it up in the realm of public and private nuisance as provided for under the common law of Massachusetts. And that means there are issues here that, as the plans and design exists right now, have the potential, if not addressed in creative and thoughtful ways, have the potential to infringe on rights that these abutters, neighbors, and the town have, giving the appearance that the project, because of its scope and size, raises the issue that, again, the applicant has not asked for waivers, and we cannot waive those certain issues that I've just brought up. So I encourage the developer to work diligently to alleviate any of the issues that would fall under the realm of public-private nuisance, where these perhaps encroachments or discharges may infringe upon the rights of neighbors. One of the other issues that I wanted to bring up is now for a second time, and I know the developer's revamping plans. We really want to see some plans that show 20 affordable units. The drawing that was submitted at the first hearing was incorrect. That was the one that was used for the peer review study. The mass housing application, approval, was conditional upon the 20 unit minimum, so we really want to see where those are sited and located. I don't want, again, I'm not going to necessarily beat it to death, but you know, the scope, the parking, and the safety issues here are going to be things that, we're really going to want the developer to address in the large amount of homework that they have. Thank you.
I would agree with the other board members. We've sat here, now this is the second meeting that we've sat on, and the public has noted comments at the first meeting. There was a selectmen's meeting. I sat in on that. Public commented there, DRT meetings. And I think you've heard at every meeting, everybody feels that the density is just way too much. You heard it from the board members here. It seems, I don't know what's driving it, the number of spaces and et cetera, but I think you have to, at some point here, start looking into cutting back. It's just not going to work. It's not going to work with the area you have, the number of parking spaces. I think you're getting into safety issues when you start going down to one space per unit. You're going to have too many people vying for the parking spaces under there. You're going to end up with people parking who they're not supposed to be parking. Very dangerous. I don't see any pedestrian path under that building. I think that was brought up in the traffic report. I get visions of pedestrians going to their car and people backing out of parking spaces, getting injured or something. It just isn't working. 77 units, I don't know. I think you could easily cut the top floor, cut a floor out of it, and I think you have to reduce the number of units. And I think what's driving it is this area that you have for the parking. And at 1.5 spaces per unit, I think that's what you have. You have to have visitor parking. That's accounted in the 1.5 spaces. You have to have loading areas. You're going to have moving vans coming in and out of there. These are apartments. They're not houses where people are going to be staying and living for 20 years. These are apartments where there's going to be residents moving in and out. The vans have to get in there. What are they going to do? Park on Prescott Street and take their furniture in from the street? I think they have to get in there to the elevator. When somebody like that is using that single elevator to load and bring furniture, to bring moving in and out of apartments, how do the residents in the apartment then get in and out of their apartments in downtown or get out of the building? I think these are all questions that need to be answered and will be answered if you reduce the number of units. And I think the elevator question that the architect brought up is excellent on that. I like that he brought up the aspect of you. And I know these are preliminary plans that have been presented, and you planned on an elevator. You can get into the details of it. But we don't want to be seeing a roof plan and then having to have a penthouse on top of the roof to have elevator equipment up there. We need some more detail on that. Question I did have for Matt of Judy Nitsch, and you notice that now I haven't walked the site. It's not my property. I don't go on it and start walking around without an invite or something. But you did note that there were several monitoring wells on the site. Do you know what they are? Or?
I don't.
Don't, yeah. I don't know if the town does, or maybe that's something Matt can answer when we give him the floor here.
I identified those wells just because I noticed them on the site.
Right.
They are noted on the survey that they provided.
Yeah.
But there's no information as to what they're for or whether they need to remain following the project, whether they would be infected by this.
I don't know if they're DEP monitoring wells. Obviously,
Right.
The structure on the corner was a former gas station, I believe. It no longer has gas there, but at one time could have been underground tanks that leaked or something, and we don't know. But, and that was the other question I have for the applicant or the developer is, have you looked into acquiring that corner parcel to serve a station? Obviously, that would make things a lot easier for you, and I wholeheartedly agree with the architect in regards to viewing the project. That would be good. So those are my comments. Matt?
All right.
Yeah.
So, I don't know where to start specifically, but
right.
First, thank the peer reviews. There were some really good comments, insightful, some more detail than we've got to at this point, and some that are will be answered, and some that may change or go away as we make changes. I think I started the meeting by saying we anticipate making design changes after this.
Mm-hmm.
What we're trying to do is make design changes that actually have a real impact and not just a perceived impact. So when we listen to peer review comments, the board's comments, neighbors' comments, the direct abutters, who we've met with four already, that will help guide us as we make these changes. Getting to the density question, I have this discussion all the time on density. You know, clearly, we could make these all three-bedroom units and have a very much lower density unit count just on its face. But that, you know, so there's lots of things at play. There's unit count, there's floor area ratio, there's parking ratio. So we're not going to just sit here and say, yeah, we'll make it all two bedrooms and it goes down to 60 units and that get, you know, that isn't get, you know, we've heard density, we've heard height, we've heard parking. So we hear these things. We have to start at a point. So what we do when we start with a design is we try to gather the information. We obviously don't use Boston density, or Cambridge, but we try to find similar densities, similar communities, and try to see those projects that are successful. And there are some. So what's very unique about this site is it is in the downtown area, and there is a push by the town to revitalize this, as evidenced by the many master plans that have been put out through the year, and it is at a commuter rail. Oftentimes, you see one or the other, and the site is either at the commuter rail or it's downtown. And there's few towns that have both. And one I'll cite specifically is Beverly. They had a big push to their downtown Rantoul Street. A number of those projects, and I'll cite the Enterprise Beverly on Rantoul Street, is 46 units on a 22,000 square foot lot, which is a 90 units per acre. Depot Square, and that was built in 2013, was built in 2006. It's 48 units on a 16,000 square foot site, which is 126 units per acre. And then I could go on, there's other, so there are examples of at least where we had to start somewhere. So we looked at the site. It's a great site to add density. I think in the 2015 draft report the town just put out, it identified this as a site for multifamily use, and I believe the report cited 10,000 square feet of commercial and 80 units. We didn't prepare it. So we have to start at a point with density. With that said, we've heard loud and clear from the density standpoint, the parking standpoint, and the height standpoint. Good comments. We're going to make some changes, and so some of those issues, there's always the quick, just do this and that makes it go away. Well, it may and it may not. Maybe it's not just as easy as do this and those problems go away. We'll look at all that, and we've started looking at all that as we go through this and we continue to hear comments. And also the peer review comments were helpful as we formulate some of those changes. So it's a process that we go through. What we'll do too, and we're in the process, is we'll 3D model that building, because it's hard to see kind of when we're just showing preliminarily two elevations, what people will see from different points. I think it'll be very helpful for people to see as you go around the building from a 3D modeling perspective, what that means and what those changes mean. Another thing we clearly will do between now and then is a landscaping plan. We've talked with neighbors, talking with here, and once we make those changes to see what that means, but clearly a more developed, an actual landscape plan is something too that needs to be provided. And there's some great smaller detailed questions that need to be answered. There's some code ones, so we're gonna go through that. We have a long list, but the big issues we've heard height and density, and we'll look at that. Some of the buildings I reference are ground level parking four stories above, so it's not unheard of. And some of those buildings, I say, in Beverly are, you know, in front of residential neighborhoods. So I think there was a great comment at the selectmen meeting by one of the selectmen about, and maybe one of the CBDC members, it's a transitional site. You have on the front the train station in downtown, and on the back is residential. I think that's something that we'll take into consideration, see, you know, because you have that dichotomy of kind of both sides of the building as we develop these plans. So height and density, we started somewhere. That's how we came up with that number. I think the parking count is a very unique question. You know, the standard in the town is 1.5. I think, you know, if you looked at 30 Haven, it was 1.2. And we're working with them to see if they actually need the 1.2, if it was less. You know, back to the density for a second. Ours right now proposed is 92, almost 93 units an acre. 30 Haven that was approved is 73 units an acre. And it has commercial. So if you factor in, it is a different project, but when you factor in, say, floor area ratio, even if you count our garage, which is the amount of square footage in the building divided by the lot size, we're actually, even if you count our garage, we're less than they are floor area ratio. So density means different things in different circumstances. But with that said, we're going to look at ways we could reduce certain things, and there's no easy answer at this point. Just on the parking, I want to point out there's a push in many transit projects to reduce that down to 1.0. I'll actually read from a report where it says residential requirements should not exceed one space per unit, regardless of the size of the unit. And that was actually a report from 2009. It was the Town of Reading Comprehensive Parking Program. So these are things we gather. We don't just make it up when we try to design our program. So there was a push by the town to encourage development downtown and at the same time reduce the parking requirements. Not saying that that's the right number or that's where we'll end up, but that's how we've formulated where we've got to today. And I think that report was prepared by the town well before we were involved. It's a very interesting, informative report that I would suggest everybody take a look at, because I think it talks about parking spaces downtown, how to better use parking spaces, has a number of recommendations. So, but, you know, I'll be back to the beginning. It's a great site and a great downtown area and a commuter rail. We know we have work to do on the bigger picture and obviously also on the details. So I would imagine at the next meeting, we'll be able to present some additional stuff as well as start answering some of the questions that have been brought up tonight. So we look at the process. We look forward to going through the process. And like I said, having everyone here and hearing the comments, it helps the process. And it usually gets you to a much better point than where you started. So.
Thank you, Matt. Question I did ask. Now, has there been any inquiries in regards to the corner lot?
As you can imagine, we've certainly tried to buy the corner lot. And I'll just leave it at, you know, we'd love to get it, and we'd love to get it at a point, you know, it's the business too. So
there's been no agreement as yet, is what you're saying.
You could always do something, but the amount of units you would need to fit on to make it work at some point, you know, we want to make it work for the town too, and for us. So we entertained it. We spent a long time working on it at the beginning, and you know, we would, you know, love to have the corner piece, but we don't. So we have to work with what we have.
I think we would all look forward to seeing a revamped project here based on what you've heard. You know, from a couple of meetings with the zoning board, what you've heard from the public, and from what you've heard from the peer reviews, and come back with something that certainly may be more palatable.
Just on what you're deep specific on the modern wells, we did a detailed environmental report when we started this, as you can imagine. So we left those in, and the results were, surprisingly, there was no problem on the site, so we have a clean environmental report on the site.
Those were from projects.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So,
thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I ask, Matt, if as you go through some of the modifications or whatever you want to make to the initial project, would you also be cognizant on any additional waivers or deletion of waivers so that as you bring that forward, the board will have an idea of where the waivers are, because they're fairly extensive now, and we know we can't meet some of them.
Right, and I think there was one brought up tonight that I hadn't thought of. So yes, we will definitely refine this, go through that list, and make sure it's accurate.
Okay. Thank you. No further questions, I think. I can open this up for...
Mr. Chair, can I make a
comment?
Hi, I just wanted to...
Julie.
Jean Delio, Assistant Town Manager. I just wanted to clarify some of the statements that we just made about what the town is pushing for. We've done a lot of master planning. We had a lot of charrettes in this room. We were not pushing for this level of density in this location. We were not pushing for this portion of the downtown to be have a piece carved out and then this 63-foot tall building. So I just want to make that very clear. In our economic development report, which is on the website, it shows that we had a lot of discussion about what kind of density would work. Do we think this would be a good location for housing? Yes. And mixed use, even better. And we talked a lot, ad nauseum, about what the density would look like, and it wasn't like this. So I just want to make that very clear, because it makes it, the picture was painted a little bit differently. I also want to clarify the parking for 30 Haven Street. I think you said, Matt, that it was 1.2 per unit. It's actually 1.38. So it's closer to 1.4 per unit at 30 Haven.
Are you including the retail, the spaces dedicated to the retail units?
No, I'm just talking about how many spaces are there. It's based on just the gross number.
There are 6 units dedicated to the retail, so that number is actually lower.
Okay, well, the way we're looking at it broadly is it's more than just 1.2. And we can split hairs all day long about this, but we, again, talked long and hard when we adopted the 40R district, and the parking ratio that we arrived at as a community was 1.25 per unit. And we did start with 1, and the community said no. So we've had that conversation about 1 unit per parking space, and it didn't fly in this town. And so town meeting adopted a zoning that said 1.25 per unit.
And that's mixed use, Gene, you
said. Mixed
say.
Use.
Yes.
Yep. That could be for the residential only as well. But our preference really is mixed use, and we'd love to see a project with, you're talking about Rantoul Street. I mean, Rantoul Street is like 28. I mean, it's a massive corridor through Beverly. So we'd love to see, commercial on the first floor and residential up above, and to use this transition area to really embrace that concept. So I just wanted to make those comments just to clarify. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Gene, for clarifying that. Okay, I can open this up now for the public comment period. As I noted before, state your name and street address for the record. Face and address the ZBA when speaking. Be respectful and stay clear of personal attacks. And please, no shouting, clapping, or other demonstrations. Okay, we will open up the public comment section. Yes.
What was still 35 Washington Street? It has already been established that the number of parking spaces for the 77 units I learned tonight has even been decreased from what I thought, and it may even be decreased more if you put up the columns to help hold up the building. I realize that some people will take public transportation, but one unit could possibly have a couple where both works in different towns, which would mean 2 cars per unit. You also mentioned that the other thing is people need cars to go grocery shopping, unless you want to put a grocery store where certainly wood is. But you mentioned that you were going to look for other places to park all these extra cars. I don't think there's much available in Reading already, as you can see how the neighborhoods are really inundated with commuters now. So that is my main, I just don't know where all these other cars are going to be put, because there will be more. And just as a side, I don't think one elevator is enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other comments from people? Yes, sir.
I guess I should stand up. David Tuttle, Pender Drive in Reading, and a member of the CPDC and town meeting. The parking and density have been discussed extensively, and I believe that you already know my opinion on that. I'm a little disappointed that we haven't seen a better rendering of what the proposed building would actually look like. If you're standing on, it's not Lincoln Prescott Street, or Lincoln Street is the one that comes along the front of the building.
Yes.
What you would actually see is not the picture that's shown. What you would see was that plus a third again as much from the angled front portion of the building plus the end facade of the building B. So you would see a facade which is about twice what's shown in the diagram. And the same thing is true if you're standing at the train station or if you're on Washington Street and you look through to see the rear of the building, it's fully twice the size of what we see in the rendering. Now, it's a pretty building, but that isn't what we would see.
Thank you. Where are the comments? Yes, back there.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, 125 Summer Avenue. I have two comments and a question. My first comment is that I may be a little naive, but I actually was very shocked by the engineer's report, and I'm surprised at the lack of in terms of the way he described the interior staircases and the height won't be allowed inside. I'm just surprised at that they didn't cover all that at this point in the game. I mean, I know they're not completely detailed, but I think they should have been. I'm concerned about the competence of the developers at this point. And I don't feel that they're particularly trustworthy. I don't feel they've earned our trust at this point for a number of different reasons, but including that. Second, as someone who kind of is looking at whether or not my husband and I would, downsize and always being interested in being in Reading and looking at this, I look at that and say, well, each unit may be individually lovely. To me, it's totally claustrophobic. It's totally impractical. When you think about people coming in and moving and having to walk and whatever, it just seems it wasn't thoughtful in that way, not very user-friendly, not neighborhood-friendly, not user-friendly. My question is, if occupants of these apartments are residents of Reading, will they be then entitled to buy a compost parking sticker and park and have visitors park on the street? Because people rely on Prescott Street as parking for, to commute and use the train. And we're just going to put a huge burden and really interfere with our commuter parking with the problems that are arising with their lack of parking and propose offsite parking when you have, again, it's so well used by money provided by commuters all day long. I think we're have some huge issues. So would they then also be allowed to buy the resident permits and also park on the street?
Okay, thank you. Further comments? Okay, right here. Yes, sir.
I wanted to express one concern that wasn't mentioned around the parking. My name is Nick Gagnon. I live at 76 Washington Street. I'm a direct abutter to the structure, the proposed plan. And my concern I have is, I have many, but one of the concerns I haven't heard addressed or mentioned is the potential impact on the noise that will be created by the parking. So my concern is that the back of the parking is going to be open and you have a steel structure with cars underneath. So when the cars start, and we're talking about 100 cars a day starting, is it going to be living next to an underground garage, or is there going to be some thought put into the design of the structure to dampen the noise for the neighbors to make sure that you're not disrupted that way? And in this one comment that I've heard the developer mention around thinking of designing this as a downtown area, I would disagree that this is downtown Reading. I think this is a site that is in proximity to downtown Reading, but in my mind, downtown Reading is Main Street, Haven Street. It is not on this on this side of the track. I don't consider that I live in a downtown area. I live in a residential, quiet area of Reading.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Joe Carter, 49 Riverside Drive. I've been to, I think, every meeting so far, and it's. I agree with Marilyn. It's the same thing. We keep hearing there's a lot of issues that need to be addressed. This is a work in progress, and it's pretty much those are the same slides that I've looked at past how many meetings that we've been to. You know, I mean, it's just getting a little old and redundant, and I think we, as you know, a lot of people here, and we want answers. We're not here, you know, just because we have no place to go on a Thursday night. That said, last meeting it was addressed that if you wanted to make this more transportation friendly, I can't remember how you worded it, but it was more
transit oriented.
Like we are in Boston or Cambridge or Somerville, and we're not. This is the town of Reading. This isn't the city of Reading, it's the town of Reading. You don't even have room in this densely populated plan area to plant a blade of grass. You were talked about zip cars. You were talked about alternative transportation. It looks to me there's not a place to put bike racks. Are people going to be biking? Well, you know, and with the one elevator, they're going to have their bikes on their shoulder coming down, you know, five flights of stairs. It's just everything it seems to me that you're saying sounds great, but the next time you meet, you're not following up on any of it. And I feel like it's Groundhog Day. I feel like this is exactly what we heard last time. And I don't know. I'm just getting a little shaded in the way. So thank you.
Yes, developer, I think we'd like to respond to that.
Just for the record, Jeff Mengler, I appreciate a lot from the FCB. I'm a consultant to the applicant. I appreciate a lot of the comments relative to Groundhog Day and the plans being the same. I can, putting myself in your position, I can understand that. But let me explain the process just a little bit. Whether or not you agree with it is a different issue. My client just gave the town $25,000 for peer review consultants. Would it be an efficient process for him to have changed the plans over the last few weeks when the peer review consultants are reviewing a different plan, and then they come and say, wait a second, we just peer reviewed a different plan, and we show up with different plans. It's not effective. As they say, forgive me for my golf analogy, the Masters doesn't start till the back nine on Sunday. A 40B process doesn't really start until the peer review comments come in. Now we have the benefit of quite good comments from three competent professionals, and it's now incumbent on my client to interpret those comments, to interact. I can tell you this for certain, that a lot of the comments that we heard tonight can probably be explained to the satisfaction of these three individuals over an hour conversation, because professionals sometimes look at plans differently. Are there issues in the plans? Absolutely. Do they have to be solved? Absolutely. And all of that really needs to happen in earnest. If we're here in another meeting or two and we're showing you the same elevations and the same parking plan and everything's the same, then yes, you have every right to say, what is going on? But now that the peer review has happened, the town has directed us to respond. They've asked us very good questions. I think you will start to see changes that whether or not they're to the level that you want remains to be seen, admittedly, but you will start to see changes. So I don't think it's fair to characterize. I mean, I've worked with a lot of these professionals before. I can tell you they're quite competent, and they will address these questions. So I don't think some of those characterizations are necessarily fair. I understand some of the confusion and frustration perhaps in the process, but I think if you give it a little bit more time, you're going to start to see some of the benefits of that commentary that we received. So, and the only other comment I would make, and this is a little bit more specific, is there's two really divergent messages being coming from the town and the neighborhood. You clearly heard parking is a big issue, but then at the same time, commercial on the first floor, I can tell you for a fact, and I don't want to put the town's peer reviewer on the spot, we could take two floors off the building, and you put commercial on the first floor of that building, and the parking requirements go through the roof. The amount of traffic goes through the roof. So it's inconsistent to say, we'd love mixed-use development, we want commercial here. Oh, but you don't have enough parking. We're not going to be doing a mixed-use development, so it's kind of an obsolete issue. But I can tell you, the requirement for parking and the generation of trips from commercial is greatly above any kind of residential use. I'm not a traffic engineer, but believe me, I've sat through enough of these, and I am a developer, to feel confident saying that. So I just want that out there for people to contemplate, because I think it's important to understand that. Thank you.
Okay, yes, sir. What? Yeah, right here.
Yeah, Josh LeMay, 83 Prescott. I just first off wanted to thank the peer reviewers for the great job they did. It was very enlightening for me being in this field. I would also just like to say that the parking issue from a commuter perspective, it actually extends into Washington Street and onto Sunnyside. So it's the commuter parking as it exists today on a day-to-day basis. I walk past it every day, both like twice a day, and it's much bigger than just the 8 spots in front of the building. So the spillover from any kind of additional requirements for parking within the residence of the building itself would exacerbate that problem pretty significantly. Right now I'm lucky because they don't park in front of my house yet, but I think that would certainly be a problem. Second issue that I have, I just wondered if there's any consideration for making this a green certified building since it's a new development, and I think that would be a nice token of goodwill for the town if there was major development with some kind of appreciation for the environment. The third thing being that from a personal perspective, I am head of household for a young family. A lot of people move to Reading because of the school system, and their home values are tied directly to the school system and the quality of it. And I was just wondering if there's data about buildings like 30 Haven for the number of kids that injects into the school system that has already stretched the limits. Like, my nephew was in kindergarten in a modular classroom, and that's been happening more and more. There's more modular classrooms being added, I think, every year. So just wanted to put that out there as a concern that's definitely indirectly related to this project, not to harp on parking density entirely, but very related.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Eileen Manning from Sun Manor Side Drive. In answer to your question, 30 Haven added 12 students to the school system. I have a comment on the peer review process, and I felt like it was very thorough and very helpful to me personally. However, I'm a little concerned that it seems like particularly the engineering did not have all the information they needed to complete their peer review. It sounded like they didn't have information on power and utilities, whether a transformer was needed, ice and snow removal, site lighting, connection with sewer system, and stormwater and runoff. That seems like things they should have had to do their peer review. And I have a question for the board, how is that now handled? Once that information comes in, do we still have access to that resource to have them fully review that information, or is that now on all of you?
Yes, it will be. That will be responded to by the applicants, engineers, to the engineers, and that will be on the town website when it comes in.
Thank you.
It will be. Yes, sir, over there. Okay. Yeah.
Joe Barletta, I own 1 3 Fulton Street, which is in the butter. I have just one mistake. I've owned the house since her family, two bedrooms on each unit, since 2000, and I've never had a tenant that actually
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Mona. I live on Riverside Drive. I cannot drive. I'm a commuter on foot, pedestrian everywhere I go. There's a certain peacefulness at the train station on Saturday and Sunday when the cars are not parked everywhere. I walk my dog there. I walk to the supermarket. I walk to CVS. I come home on the last commuter train on the weeknights. So you're getting home almost at 1 a.m. It's already scary enough walking down the dark street. So with this complex and all these people, are there going to be people just enjoying the evening hanging out? Am I going to be petrified by my life when I get off the train station wondering if somebody's going to come up and rob or attack me? That's possible, maybe, or maybe not. I also take the commuter train in the afternoon because I work an odd shift. So going to the commuter station at 12 o'clock, there's a peacefulness there because there are no cars going in and out because nobody's coming home at that time. So with the structure there, and you were saying in the morning, 40 people are going to be leaving, driving up, and probably during the evening when they come home, there'll be 60, 70 cars in and out. There's going to be cars going in and out, going to the supermarket, in and out, in and out. It's just going to be like my living back in Palm Mall in Boston, near Boston University. I left there to come here, like the gentleman said about growing, you know, having his children grow up here and just being residential. People who live in Reading pay enormous amount of taxes to get away from being in the city. I grew up there. I don't want to be on that again. So every day from here, I'm going to be walking by the structure, going home every day, Monday through Friday, Saturday, Sunday, going to the supermarket, everywhere I go. And the gentleman in the front was talking about, I guess you were talking about going to Main Street, going by McDonald's. There's going to be traffic that way too. Everywhere there's going to be just traffic. And if you're going in and out of the complex on Prescott Street, how much traffic is there going to be? Even now, when I'm walking from the train station, to get across the street, no offense to the drivers, and everybody's a driver, I can't even get people stopped to let me cross the street with my dog. I'm standing there, it's like, you want to say, are you blind? Did you not see me? So with all of this, on Prescott, when I'm walking my dog, no matter what time there's peacefulness, there's going to be just cars. There's no peacefulness. And I don't want to have to circumvent my route to go around and around and around just to get to CVS from another street to avoid this whole complex, because it would be almost, you know, mental, sadness to me to see all this. I don't even going on. And once open space is gone, it's gone. Mm-hmm. They did a lot of construction in the city of Boston, and you know, people, you have to remember, once open space is gone, that's it. You know, you put up a structure, you're not going to tear it down just because later on there's going to be a problem. So that's what I have to say, because I just walk everywhere. Everywhere I go, I walk. So. You just want the peacefulness of it. You know, everybody in Reading likes peacefulness. That's why a lot of people live here. And at my age, I don't want to be saying, well, let me move somewhere else that's going to be more peaceful, because I don't drive, so I'm not going to be able to do that. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Hi, Josh Walker on 128 Woburn Street. And we live on the corner of Woburn and Arlington, and Pete's a neighbor of mine on Washington Street, and I made a comment to him that they already use Arlington Street as a cut-through. It's a racetrack going down, especially when everything's going on there. And for a lot of the regions, you'll come out and literally there'll be cars that can get up to 50 miles an hour, and they just race down that street. That's certainly one implication. And the only other comment really that I want to make, I think it's really obvious, and I certainly want to, I understand and respect what these guys are trying to do. They're developers, they're in business. That's a spectacular piece of property here in Reddington. It really is. You're right by the railroad station. And the fact that you can't get that corner piece, I mean, it just doesn't work. I mean, you need something that's fluid, it's got to kind of wrap around. I mean, you could really build something magnificent there that really, really fits. And I understand what you guys are trying to do, and you just, you know, and unless old man Brown wants to sell that lot, you know, I know he probably would. He probably wants a lot of money for it. The fact is that it just can't, and I don't mean old man Brown. I'm sorry, I meant that. But it needs to, that's got to wrap around that corner.
Yes, ma'am.
Christine Lusk, I live at 52 Washington Street, and I do think living so close to it that one area, or in Josh just brought up, is we aren't really looking at the intersection of Woburn and Lincoln Street, and most people who live in this area do not drive down to Lincoln Street to go up and take a right on Woburn Street, because the traffic really backs up when the train goes by, the gates go down. The traffic can back all the way up to Washington Street. When I'm coming out of Washington Street, that's how far back of it. So we really need to look at that intersection. And you mentioned that we need to look at the intersection of Main and Washington, and that is a very important intersection. However, it's not the only way out of this area. If I want to go north, I will go up to Woburn Street and take a left on High Street to get to 93, or I'll go straight up Woburn Street and then take a left on Main Street. So that's a very important intersection to study. Further, in terms of walking studies, the other day I took a walk to my dentist, and I realized that to walk from this area, the quickest way to get there is to walk straight down the train tracks. Now, if we're expecting that people are going to live in this building without a car, and they want to walk to the grocery store, they're going to walk to a Market Basket or to Stop and Shop. Now, if you have both hands way down with shopping bags, are you going to walk all the way around? Are you going to say, I'll just zip down the train tracks? So I really would like us to look at how we're going to ensure that pedestrians don't walk down the train tracks. Further, if you are going to walk down there, if you go down and then cut down Ash Street, and then you're crossing right in front of McDonald's, which, as everybody in Reading knows, is like the most dangerous intersection place to cross the street. So I really would encourage the parking pedestrian consultants to really examine those intersections. I have a second question, which is, I just don't understand if this is really two different buildings, and was it part of the zoning to be a 40B? Does it have to be one building? Because it's really two buildings, so I just don't understand why they're saying it's one building if it's really two. Mm. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm Jean Thomas, and I live on Gracie. So slow down. 21 Arlington Street, and I'm going to speak on the behalf of another very small, very tax street, and that's Minot Street, mm-hmm. which is in mm-hmm. not, it's in poor condition, or Minot Street and the people who live off of it. And your tenants are not going to be happy driving on Minot Street, although you're predicting that that will be a street that they may use. No one's going to be happy. It's in bad shape, and Little Arlington Street, when cars are parked, when we park in front of our houses, and we can only park on one side, there's essentially one lane of traffic. Two cars cannot pass one another. All right, I'd like you to think about the environmental concerns. The taking down of the building, concerned about the dust and the confusion that the construction workers' own vehicles and the high volume of big machinery that you need, concerned about that. But once the building is up, is it a presumption or an assumption that you can take part of Prescott Street? I want a setback. I would like to see those trees. You had trees along Prescott Street for the garage. That's terrific. We need more trees. In fact, maybe like Warby Parker, they give away a pair of glasses every time you buy one. Maybe you could plant something for every apartment, you know, because the carbon dioxide, I know that's flippant, but the carbon dioxide, the emissions from this building are going to be very, very significant. Very significant. And they're coming out the back. The front apparently is sealed. If the trash truck can't get in, and I know that the chutes are going down to a basement that we haven't even thought about, the basement part, do the big green bins get pushed out on the street? Are we going to see garbage trucks loading garbage from, you know, from dumpsters? Is that going to happen? And how many times a week is garbage collection for a building like that? We have it once a week. But I would imagine that a commercial building, I've lived in apartments, and it was always a super who took care of problems very quickly because he was there. There was always a freight elevator besides a passenger elevator. as somebody else said, in apartments, people are transit. They're going in and out. And another thing, why is the two-way entrance exit not on Lincoln Street instead of on Prescott Street, which is so taxed? When that sidewalk, and I'm glad you said that you're going to pay for the sidewalks, because that's a question. And I also am concerned about who's going to take the responsibility of the snow removal from the overhang dumping on the sidewalk, you know? But the elimination of those parking spaces on Prescott Street and narrowing Prescott Street is really unconscionable. It's unfair to the people who are currently here, and you want them, I'm going to downsize sometime. You want us to be neighborly to you too. And I think that's, we need a good neighbor. One more thing. There is underground water, and somebody else can speak to this much better than I can, but there is underground water, which was an issue for the Haven Street. And if you stand at Green Tomato, which is at that triangular property at the point of it, there's a drain basin there, and there's constantly water running because there's an underground stream, and it affects us on the other side of the track. It affects the area of your property. So that's a major study in itself. So, okay, environmental concerns, please. Thank you. And neighborliness.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Mary Ann Downing, 1300 Drive. I want to address the developer who just mentioned two complexes in Beverly, Depot Square, and Enterprise Apartments. So, I mean, I was bringing up pictures of these on my phone, and they are not butt up against single-family homes, as best as I can tell from the multiple images here. You can correct me if I'm wrong, because this is the first I've heard of them. So I think if you were proposing this development and putting it like next to the Carrick building, we'd be applauding you. That's the perfect place for it, for something of this density. When you look at like the Cloverleaf apartments out in Data and other things, they're all like in the middle of retail areas. Yeah, that's fine to put five stories and 100 units an acre. So, you know, correct me if I'm wrong about what you said. You said Depot Square and Enterprise are good examples of dense developments that are near residential, but they don't look like they're near this kind of residential, you know, 2 to 5 feet from the property line. And just the other comment I had was to Mr. Engler, I guess, who said, you know, we're not gonna do mixed use. And the originally signed purchase and sale agreement, paragraph 23, you made, this was contingent upon getting approval of this site as a designated smart growth area, and then you later amended that to be 40B. I'm just curious why, because it sounded like you wanted to have it be a 40R, and then at some point, it's a little tough to tell on what was posted when you executed these documents, so why did you change your mind? I'm just curious. And stop from 40R and go to 40B. Thanks.
Okay. Matt, we'll give you, you know, you have the comment. If you would like to respond at the next meeting, you know, with a written response to that, that'll be fine. But you do have the comment. Okay. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
We had talked about this before, and the architect was gracious enough to answer my question relative to accessibility. Particularly in regards to transportation for those who have challenges of disabilities. The parking spaces, you only have two of them. There's only one elevator in the building. What is the location specifically of those handicapped apartments? And do they have another form of egress from those apartments in the event of an emergency? That's very important. I'm sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. Christine Hansen, I live at 30 Haven Street here in Reading. The other question becomes that many individuals within our community who live downtown may be elderly or disabled, and they use transportation such as the ride or mass transit. that necessitates them having access directly from the building for them to be picked up there. There's already a question from the peer review relative to transportation as to the loss of parking that's already along Prospect Street, and that I don't know if the gentleman is willing to grant access to the ride to pick up your residents who should choose to use the ride. And if there would be a ramp that would enable them to use either a rollator or a wheelchair, whatever the case may be, that they use as an assistive device. Those are just some of the other questions relative to accessibility.
Okay. Thank you. There's no further comments from the. Yeah, one more comment then, right here. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Stephen Wanish. I live at 38 Wyandot Street, just down the way off the screen here. Last meeting that was held in this room, I spoke in favor of this development. I still think that this has a great potential to improve a lot of things here in Reading. I just like to highlight that, many times we've got, I don't know how many, town days and, trying to get people to turn through downtown. There's a lot of streetscaping that's done in Main Street. And I think that it's obvious that, to get people to use downtown, you have to have people living near downtown. I can understand that there's a lot of concerns with density. This is, however, very close to the train station, and so I think that does offer some balancing. I'm a bit disappointed, though, that the applicant hasn't given us a little bit more to chew on. I do understand, however, that, we're just getting through our design reviews from the consultants. So I'd just like to offer that, given time to give us something that's a little bit different here. I'm really hoping that we're going to be able to put something together that's actually going to work for the town and for the people living around.
Okay, thank you. Okay, time for one more.
My name is Gerald, 35 Sunnyside Avenue. I can attest to the people parking on my street because I live there.
If you could direct comment to the board.
Oh,
yes.
Sorry.
To us.
Us.
To the board.
Oh. We're the board. That's all right. That's all right.
People all the way at Prescott Street and partway down Sunnyside Avenue. And the other concern is it doesn't hurt me or bother me directly because I'm not an abutter. But I do have concern for those who are abutters and what it's going to do to their property value.
Thank you. Okay. I will close the public portion tonight. We will have more meetings on this, and we will still entertain public comments as we go along. We will conclude with some more board business here tonight on this. And I wanted to bring up to the board that in the, in the memorandum of the zoning board from the town, from Julie Murphy, in regards to the town, in regards to the zoning ones on page 2. And Gene had particularly asked me to look at this, and we should maybe take a vote on this tonight. Additional peer review study. See that section at the bottom? And you might want to take a quick glance at that. And correct me if I'm wrong, Gene, you were looking to get a vote on this tonight?
Yeah.
A direction from the board if we should proceed or not with these additional peer review studies. One of them, a feasibility study for the project with the inclusion of the gas station parcel, a phase one environmental study of groundwater and soil given its proximity to the service station, and the town of Reading's water and sewer capacity analysis to determine if the existing pump station and piping infrastructure can handle the added inflows and wastewater from the development. And I think we brought these up before, but they're looking for some direction tonight on that. Traffic parking study with the scope expanded beyond the three study intersections. And off-site parking utilization study and a fire and public safety study. So those are additional peer reviews that the town thought might be helpful, and they wanted to bring that up to us and ask for our direction on that. I'll take some comments. John?
Well, I think that one of the issues... We're still in session, please.
Yeah. Could you close the door, please? And if you're going to have any conversations outside the door, please. Thank you. Yes, John.
I think in a number of these situations, the developer needs to come back to the board. We haven't set a date certain to when they believe they can have something together for us to come back here again. But during that process, I think rather than pay for a feasibility study based upon this, if it's 77 units and they're not going to change their mind, I think it's appropriate. I think if they're going to make conditional changes, then why would a developer want to pay twice? Once on the 77 units and again on something less than 77 units or a change or modification. So I think a lot of this peer review, they've come forward and said, yes, they're interested in doing a peer review. It's going to help them out as much as the board and the town. But to go out and get somebody to do this now based upon 77, as a developer, I would say, it's not reasonable at this point. But to do this along the lines, I'd have to ask the developers, you know, are some of the issues that have presented this thus far going to be helpful to them as much as it is to us? And if so, I think they need to work with the staff because they can't work with the board at this point. They're working with the staff, with Julie and Jean and other daytime people. When this comes in, are you interested in working on some of these issues with the town? And is this going to be helpful to you?
Can I just ask a clarifying question? I mean, first, on the parking issue, the traffic issue, I think we heard the peer review consultant say, correct me if I'm wrong, sir, that the intersections that were included were the right, that is the right scope for the traffic study. So I think that question's been answered. The question I have for you is that I'm sorry because I couldn't hear it because of the commotion over here, but I know that there was a question about a feasibility study for the 77 units. What would that feasibility study include?
It was a feasibility study for the project with the inclusion of the gas station parcel. Okay. Is what the feasibility study included.
I have one question. I think to your point, and we would ask for the permission from the board, I think a lot of progress can be made if the board allows its peer review team and we as the applicant to interact between now and the next hearing so that we can get clarification. We can say, this is what we're proposing. What do you think of it before we hardline the drawings? To have some of that collaboration, because I think that will be helpful as opposed to us submitting a whole new plan set and whenever it is and then having to look at it fresh, we'll have the benefit of some of their input in a more iterative process. I've seen that happen a lot and I find it to be pretty productive. So we would look for the board's authorization. We would certainly copy the town on any correspondence that we have with them, Jean and Julie, to know, so they stay informed as to information that's being exchanged. But to the extent that we have questions or want some preliminary, the benefit of their input, we would ask that the board authorize that.
All right, thank you.
Would it be more appropriate for you to work with our staff on board right now through the peer reviewers?
So just streamline things if you could go directly to the peer reviewers.
Well, you mentioned one thing right now. You said you're happy with what traffic came back is. I'm not happy with traffic because I think that you missed several sections, intersections that are major. If you're talking about 77 units, just to travel, you're not going to. Well, I'm not going to get into that. That's not my intention. My intention was that I think that the board acts through its staff members. and the staff members know a lot of what the town is trying to accomplish here, as you are. But working directly with our peer review people is not going to necessarily get the same results if somebody from the town is not, somebody from town government is not involved in that. If you're talking about getting the review team, the peer review team here, plus a member or two from the staff to be part of that as a board member, I wouldn't have a problem with that because I think all bases are now covered. But just for the developer yourself to work with the peer review team, it lets the town out.
I think what generally happens, and I see it on my board a lot, is there'll be emails back and forth like there have been. Everyone will be copied, and there'll be everyone's on the email, and they end up being direct, maybe, here's a response, but everyone, you know, like even when the reports are sent. So it's an inclusive process. It's not like there's, you know, we would suggest meetings without the town. So we'll go through the town on it. It just, that's how they usually, everyone usually gets on the same email and there's comments going back and forth between peer review consultants. But we will certainly go through the town on it.
Well, I think I would ask Jean how she would respond to something like this, a question such as this.
Well, there's probably a couple of ways of going at this. I personally, Julie and I have spent countless hours on this project, and I would feel a lot more comfortable to be in the room when there's discussions. We have been very forthcoming. We've sent the peer review comments as soon as we got them. We sent them to the applicant. We're engaged in this process, and I think it's in everybody's interest if we all stay in the room and negotiate and work through the issues. There are a lot of issues. We have been keeping copious notes of what needs to be addressed. I would feel a lot more comfortable if everything were in writing, so we had a written record of everything. Any emails, I think I've asked this a couple of times from the team, any emails that we all get copied on it, but I really think that we should be in the room to have the conversation. I don't think email is the same as sitting down with everybody in the room.
We agree with that. My point was, and I think Julie and Jean would agree, and I'm in the same boat. If our civil engineer says, what about these Cultec chambers and this infiltration and the rate of runoff? And Jean and Julie, like me, would not be able to understand or interpret what the questions
That's
are.
That's not true. I beg to differ with you on that.
Well, I apologize.
Yeah, we understand a lot about those things.
My point is the civil engineers, I think, are most equipped. But we will certainly direct everything to the town if that's its preference.
And I didn't imagine there'd be meetings without the town. So we're saying the same things. It'll be a process that we'll go through. It will probably just be a lot of back and forth. And everyone will be involved.
All right, Mr. Chairman, might I echo or add to what John just mentioned?
Yes, go ahead, David.
I agree with John regarding some of his comments about how comprehensive some of the peer review studies were. Some of these studies that are suggested might be necessary regardless of the size of the project. Such as, parking utilization, phase one environmental. That has nothing to do with the size of the project. That would be done regardless of the size of the project, if it's deemed necessary. So perhaps we can pick and choose or make a determination as to what additional feasibility studies might be attributable to a 77-unit development and maybe hold off on those. And perhaps if the board is so inclined, authorize or discuss authorizing studies that might have nothing to do with the size of the project.
Well,
I would agree with David on that. I tend to agree with you, John, too, in that there would be, we don't know what's coming from down the road.
Exactly.
And I'm certainly one that's hoping we're not going to be seeing in the next iteration of this 77 units and 78 parking spaces on this. Enough said on that. Hopefully we're going to see something new that maybe some of this stuff wouldn't be relevant, and we should wait till we get a updated plan.
Well, I would go along with that, Bob. My question is your time valuable? Well, of course it is. Is there value in the peer review people? Yes, it is. What about our staff members in town? No, it's not, because they get to work here all the time. I'm sorry to say it that way, DG. The reality is, we're burning daylight here. We got 180 days. We've just gone past 35 or 36 of those days. It would be lovely if we get 77 units out of this, because that would reduce our 40B options for the future, because all of them count. However, that probably is not going to happen. So my question is to you, the reality is, when could you get something back to the board or to the town by utilizing some of this negotiation process, if we can go that route, and figure out exactly where we're at? Because everybody's time is valuable, except ours. We sit here for nothing. We don't get paid for this. But the reality is that we can't keep burning daylight like this. We've got to set a time certain that you can come back. The question is, what date certain can you move to and get us something back realistically? I just throw that out there because Julie would love to wrap everything up by the 1st of May, which ain't going to happen. But unless there's some surprising things coming back in the next iteration. So question is, from my standpoint of view, when can you bring something back by doing maybe some of the negotiations with staff and bring it back to the board?
What's their meeting schedule over the next
year? Meeting schedule, the next...
First would be the next meeting.
First,
that doesn't have anything.
The first meeting in April.
What's your April meeting date?
We're open on the 14th.
Do we have any...
Your meeting on the 7th and the 21st of April.
Our vacant.
This is April vacation, just so everyone's aware.
What is it?
That school vacation week, April 21st.
Didn't we just get an updated agenda today that showed that one of those meeting days in April is full?
Yep.
Yeah,
21st is full.
Yes, it is.
Whatever applications she's got to do them on that night, because so many of the public wants to come to these meetings, not have it on April 21st.
So you don't want to add this to...
I believe the first one was vacant, and the one I saw today of the agenda, I did not print it out.
April 7th.
I believe it's vacant.
Vacant?
Yeah. The problem is we would need everything at least a week in advance.
Okay.
But that's
April 7th. No. Okay.
The time between this meeting and the next meeting, for our point, for everyone's point, is the most crucial time.
Yes.
After that, we'll probably have quicker meetings, because and then maybe not. But this is where we're going to. We've listened. It's really only our second hearing. You know, people went to the selectman meeting, but this is really only the second
hearing. Second hearing, right.
So we've gathered the first. We now have peer review consultants. We've had great comment, taking it all in. We're going to make some changes. So we need some time to do that. We probably need about 6 weeks. I know it's going to sound crazy to the board. Sometimes the board, when it's like this, we'll have a special meeting for, and I'm not suggesting, because I know it's your valuable time. But trying to find the dates that work, and sometimes your agendas are busy on certain nights too. So we also are cognizant of that.
Yeah. Well, I would tell you, in previous 40Bs that I've sat on, any Thursday that was open, if we had to, we moved to. So the way I look at it, even though the 28th of April is not
town meeting.
Yeah. Sorry.
May 5th.
It's also
town meeting.
May 19th.
You have a meeting scheduled that night. You also have a meeting scheduled on May 12th.
The 19th? I didn't see the 19th.
On the agenda that I have, it's the 12th and the 19th.
Yeah. Are they both open those nights as far as no cases scheduled?
As far as I know.
Oh, right. I thought you were meaning there were cases already scheduled on those nights.
No, you just put on your...
Okay, so there's nothing in May scheduled yet.
No, but those are the meeting dates.
Yes, okay.
So why don't we can't give them the...
Okay, we have nothing scheduled right now. It sounds like May is, and I would agree with you, Matt, being, I'm tired now, but when I was in business, 6 weeks is, that's
probably what we need.
That's a real timeline, I think.
We could... So is town meeting, is that just on that whole week, or
Monday through Thursday?
Monday through Thursday, each of the 2 weeks.
Each of the 2 weeks, okay. Yeah. And they, and, okay. Good to know. I know the 21st is vacation, and we probably would be ready for that, but I think in fairness to probably a lot of neighbors that wouldn't be for vacation. And the first, so the second Thursday.
I know we're flexible.
There's a meeting. We have one meeting on the 12th and one meeting on the 19th.
Of May.
Can we move the 12th to the 19th?
No. I don't know about actual applications on those agendas.
We have nothing scheduled for May.
I'm saying those are the dates that you're slotted to meet in May.
Wow. I think Maureen sent out an updated.
She didn't.
Really?
I can check it now for you.
It was tentatively scheduled, but maybe I'm sure that the.
Okay, you're right. She usually puts it right in the packet. Here it is. Yeah, May 12th. We have a schedule on May 12th.
But it hasn't been advertised yet, so we can move it.
Yeah.
We'll move 12th to the 19th and accommodate.
Okay, 1606.
I would suggest. Yeah. Since it hasn't been advertised, move what's on the 12th.
I would agree. Yeah, we can do that.
That's if Matt and his team thinks he can make the 12th.
He certainly can make the 12th. Yeah. I mean, we can make sooner, but given, obviously,
the town meeting takes precedence.
We can see with the town's conflicts with town meetings.
It does give enough time to really vet out some of these other details, too, probably, to go home.
Yes, we have our consultant here. I would like to.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Chrissy, town council. I think we're all working in good faith here, and I think that amount of time between this hearing and the next, it sounds as though that's needed by the applicant to make some revisions. So I think that amount of time is appropriate, but where it's the applicant who's really driving that span, I think it's appropriate for the board to ask for ask for an extension of the 180-day window. And get that agreed to now, because if we're talking about 2 months between sessions of the hearing, that is a long time, and I think we might want to bump out the end date accordingly at this point.
Okay. Do you have any suggestions in regards to what the extension would entail?
Yes.
Are we talking a month extension, or do we want to go more?
I think a month is probably reasonable, 45 days. I mean, realistically, we were probably talking 45, about a month under any circumstance, so I think a month, 45 days would be a reasonable request.
Okay.
I deal with it all the time. We're more than happy to entertain an extension at the appropriate time, because we do need this time. Now is just not, because we may need 10 days, and we may need 3 months. I mean, you want to do that extension for the right amount of time. And at this point, we'll see what progress we've made. As the meetings get closer to that, we'll certainly entertain an extension. We need the time to prepare. It's not necessarily in the future. But right now, it'd be foolish to say 30 days, or it's 45 days, or it's any amount of days, because let's see where we're at a couple meetings from now.
So right now, then, you're and let's put this out. This is the town's requesting an extension now, and you're denying that extension. That's your right.
We're more than happy to figure out the extension, the appropriate extension, and because maybe we need more than that.
Yeah.
So you want to do an extension that would be the appropriate amount of time, and it looks like we may need one. But let's see where we're not saying no, we won't give one. It's just let's figure out at the appropriate time what the appropriate extension is.
Mm-hmm.
So you are going on the record as saying that extensions are not out of the possibility.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just to keep everything in context, I agree, Gene and Julie got those reports as soon as they came in. And in fairness to the peer review consultants, they turned them around quickly, but we only got them a week ago. So we weren't going to try to do anything until we were able to get to this meeting. We've just met with four abutters in the last 10 days. I mean, we've gotten a lot of information. So we're now at a point where we can really start to make some changes that we hope will address a lot of the concerns. But we do need time to do that. we want to come back, and we don't want to see frustrated people that say, you haven't made any changes, we want to come back and say, here are the things we've heard, and here's what we think we can do to address it.
And on the record, we're committed to working. We need an extension. We're not going to tell the town at some point, this is it. We want to get all these issues out and dealt with as best as possible.
All right. It's the way it is. And, we can touch on this subject at the next meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, I make a comment.
Yes, sir.
I agree with everybody says we need to get the process going, but we're really in a data gathering mode, okay? And we really do need three things. We need peer review. We need independent review of what this proposal is on the table, okay? And so we need the peer reviewers, and we need to get those inputs in as quickly as possible, in my view. And so on the subject of what we're talking about, additional peer decisions, we may not want to make those decisions tonight and get on with it, okay? And I don't think you disagree with that. The other thing is we need to make sure the towns stay involved in this thing, because we're going to need inputs from the departments for those towns. And what the town's position is on the developers' plan and the peer reviews, okay? And we need to get that moving. Otherwise, we are going to be sitting here looking at an extension down the road, because we're moving slowly. And I would opt that we move ahead with authorizing additional peer reviews as requested tonight.
Okay. That putting that into up to is a motion set then?
You need table. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Okay. I'll second the motion.
Do I hear a second? I have a second.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask a question?
There's a motion on the table. Let us talk about it first. Thank you.
Yes. Is there further comments from board members? These are the six studies that are noted there on page 2 in the town memos report.
I think we ought to have some discussion about whether or not all of them.
Well, I was just going to make that comment.
Okay.
I certainly think we ought to authorize an investigation of water and sewer capacity, more traffic and parking, off-site parking and fire and public safety. Probably the environmental study. I would not authorize the one inclusion of gas station parcels at this point. That would be my position.
Well, groundwater, not necessarily because of its proximity to the gas station. I was concerned with the development proposal to do groundwater recharge with their stormwater collection system from the roof, and I was concerned how that would impact the groundwater, and that's why I would be concerned with that, and I would hope that study, maybe we could certainly add that to the recommendation of the study, is to include the groundwater recharge impacts.
Well, if the size of the project or scope of the project changes, what's that going to do to the groundwater recharge? Because we don't know what's coming off the roof.
We don't, John. It certainly, if it's the size now, if it shrinks a bit, I would suspect they would use the same system and use groundwater recharge on it. I agree. I mean, you could look at each one of these things and say, well, the first one, they haven't got the gas station parcel included, so what's the need of doing a feasibility study? Groundwater and soils, it might, the project size might change. Same thing with the water and sewer capacity. Project size changes, might have an impact. Same thing with the traffic and parking study. You're dealing with 60 spaces instead of 77, it might change. Oxide parking. I don't see offsite parking being an issue in this. And I'm assuming that what they mean by offsite parking is the residents parking offsite, and then, would they park offsite? I don't know.
I see four of these that.
Yeah.
Probably merit consideration,
fire and public safety,
regardless of the size of the project, that have no
much less bearing on the size of the project than they do just having an objective study. Again, just for discussion on the motion. I know you guys want to have some input, but I'm not. You'll have your time, please. I think phase one environmental could be done without regard to the size and the scope of that, just whether or not the site's dirty or clean.
Yeah.
I mean, that's regardless of the size of the project or how many units. Is it necessary? That's something that we have to talk about. But I don't think that has any bearing on the size and the scope of the development. I think the traffic and parking study with the scope expanded beyond the three study intersections, it's our prerogative to disagree with the peer reviewer regarding their conclusions based upon their peer review of the traffic study. I think that study beyond, scope beyond the three studied intersections is useful regardless of the size of the project. If it's larger or smaller, it's still going to have an impact on those greater intersections, whether or not there's 80 spaces, 100 spaces, or 30 spaces. There's going to be additional traffic, and I think that's going to impact those further intersections.
Mm-hmm.
I think an off-site parking utilization study might be helpful regardless of the size of the project. Others might differ. I think there's probably more of a need to investigate off-site parking with a larger parking capacity than there would be for a smaller parking capacity. But again, I think that's an objective study regarding where would we put additional parking if we need it. And then the fire and public safety study, I guess we could hear arguments on both sides of whether or not that's needed based upon the size and the scope of the project. But again, that's an objective code. What meets code and what doesn't meet code. Those four, I think. And I would certainly be amenable to hearing both comments from the applicant. Correct me, Gene and Julie, these are recommendations that the town has, town staff has, for additional peer review based upon what we've seen so far?
It's essentially what the list that Julie and I put together based on looking at everything.
Mm-hmm.
The one that, if I could just make a plug for, is the Town of Reading's water and sewer capacity analysis.
I was going to say that.
We
don't
right
know
now,
what the capacity of it is.
We do not have full staffing in the engineering department, so this board cannot rely on our town engineer is retiring, and we have limited staff capacity. We cannot provide that information to this board. So the only way that information can be provided is through an outside consultant.
And whether it's 30 units to go in, 60 units, or 80 units, there's an increase. And, you know, I had asked the question
we don't know
before.
Well,
we don't know what that impact is going to have. And I think what we would be looking for from the additional review study on that is, what is the additional capacity available on that?
Well, I can see three here, that being one of them, absolutely. Second one to me would be the traffic study increase to the number of intersections, because I think it goes well beyond, regardless of what it is. We need to know what the impact is going to be crossing the tracks in one way or the other in the intersection of Washington Street and Main. So to me, that expansion would be, and you've already studied, but you haven't gone far enough in my mind. And the third one I think is critical is the fire and public safety study, only because we don't know what the codes are. I don't know who out there has addressed. Do we have anybody on the fire department who knows the state codes well enough to say if we have 30 units or 50 units or 70 units or 90 units, what the codes would be? And if we don't have somebody, as you said,
Gene,
we need somebody to tell us what those codes are. So those are the three that I would.
Well, I think in this whole thing, John, we would be, and we've done it in other developments, we would be expecting a letter from the fire department, from the fire chief, in regards to the fire and public safety of this
Okay.
Project.
We've had some initial.
And I think we have had some.
Okay,
initial, yeah.
Here's my question.
Okay.
How does the board or anybody else ask a question of the letter? Does the letter come back and tell you what it means? No, it doesn't tell you the codes, unless that letter is specifically talking about the codes in reference to the number of units and the structure itself, which is the elevators, the width of the corridors, the staircases that we heard tonight get from engineering and from architectural. It's facing the wrong way. We don't know what those are. And that's a safety issue. That's not, I mean, I know if Glenn were here, he would say, well, by the time we get the new building codes from the state, as of, was it July 1 or something, we don't know what that would be. Somebody's going to have to interpret that stuff. But that's after the permit is granted, then you go to the next level.
Yeah.
And does fire and safety go to the next level? I don't know that.
Yeah. Well, I would agree that it's a relevant issue.
I guess before we vote, we ought to maybe hear from the applicant who's waiting patiently on the hand of this. So please. Please.
We can go down the list. Understandable that you need some more information. I know, and just going down the list for the inclusion of the gas station parcel, I mean, you know, that speaks for itself. The phase one environmental we have already, I think was part of our.
Would you share that with the town?
I think it was actually part of our application. And maybe I'm wrong. It may not have been put in there.
If we haven't shared it, we're happy to share it.
Yeah, that was one of the first things we did. That's an independent phase one environmental report that we have by licensed environmental company. The water and sewer capacity analysis, I think our engineer Jim Burke could speak to.
I talked to Mr. Zamboris about that specifically. He tells me that there's a gauge study that's already conducted by the town that identifies certain areas that have a significant I&I problem. I asked if there was a program together where you could actually fix a sewer manhole or a line that would take out a certain amount of flow. He said that, yes, that's available, and he's looking for that gauge study as we speak. So as far as, having a separate consultant do it, I think the study's already done, based on comments from the town engineer.
Okay, thank you.
Could I make a
Gene, is that not accurate? That's
not the approach that we'd like to take. We would like to have some, our town engineer is retiring. We are limited in resources.
If the study is done.
He can't find it, right? Did he send you a copy?
Yes, that's correct.
He sent you a copy?
No, he said he will. I'll talk to him again.
Yeah, I would not
if the study exists, there's no point in doing it again.
Well, the trick there is finding the study.
Finding it, and when was it done?
Mr. Chairman, can I make a point or ask a question? I think there's a little confusion on our part, maybe the board's part, in terms of the need for these studies. And really, I mean, you have peer reviewers. In my mind, it's expanding the scope of people you already have under contract. You have a very good civil engineer whose firm looks at I&I and stormwater all the time. Don't go out for a new peer review. Ask Mitch to say, look at this. We've been asked by the traffic consultant to look at the parking plan, and we're going to endeavor to provide all that information to the board by the next hearing. So I'm a little confused by the request for these additional studies, because I think a lot of this, in the I&I stuff, absolutely Mitch can look at that, and I understand that there's an issue with resources. But don't go out and get new people new reports and new. It's just going to complicate and slow things down. I would use your existing civil engineer. I would leverage your existing traffic consultant.
I don't believe the town would be doing that. Obviously, they would be contacting the engineers that they have on board right now and asking them if they could amend their contracts. Obviously, they're under contract to look at a specific item, a specific description of work right now. That can be expanded, certainly, if they are willing to take that on.
I believe that, is that right?
We put it right in the memo, or it's extended the existing contract.
Or amending contracts with existing consultants, so it's not.
So it may be, so basically, what she's looking for is an okay from the board, or, you know. Yeah.
You know, I think we want it done right. So I think understanding the town's resources, where they may have resources and they may not have resources.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly having the peer review consultants that are here expanded a little bit, where it makes the process better. And depending on, you know, like I said, what the town's resources are, and it depends on which department we're talking about.
Right.
So we're working on those generally, usually through the DPW, through engineering, and if he's retiring, we'll also obviously. The peer review consultant will be more involved. Off-site park utilization study, and I believe it could be an ongoing conversation between us. So I'm not quite sure what that is looking at. I mean, there's a lot of points in the 2009, I know it's old now, report, but I maybe just some clarity on what the town's looking for in terms of off-site. I mean, obviously it's clear it's off-site parking, but is it more of us looking at different ideas and having the conversation with the town, or actually somebody suggesting something? You know, we're open to hear what the town has to say. And fire and public safety is one, I think, really, until you actually design a building, it has to meet code. It's not a question. And so I think, and that code gets reviewed. At that point, I mean, it clearly goes through a very detailed review process.
Yeah, we were at the DRT meeting in February, and the building inspector actually mentioned that he would look for an independent review of our building permit. But in terms of design at this point, we put together a detailed memo for that meeting. And you know, I want to highlight that there was a memo that came out last year from the town that identified a bunch of potential safety issues. That was addressed by a letter we wrote back 30 days later. That memo was then recirculated again and again and again, and ignored the fact that we had responded to it. We then wrote another memo. Our architect put together a memo identifying all the ways that our building actually met the code. And you know, admittedly, there is a lot of confusion about what parts of the building code apply to what. And what I mean by that is I'm a licensed construction supervisor. I can build anything in the state, either by myself or with the assistance of an architect. You can go into the building code, and I assure you I can turn to a page and tell you can never do this if it's an occupancy for a hotel. You must do that very thing if it's an occupancy for multifamily. It's very confusing. There's a lot of different aspects to it. And we have looked at that, and our design meets those codes. But you know, having said that, there will be a second layer of review that's going to happen when we go for a building permit. And they're going to look at all those things about safety, about fire separations, about a hallway with elevators, all those issues.
That we pay for.
When we get the building.
And that's the process.
You heard from the applicant.
There's a motion on the table that has a second to do all of these. Isn't that right, Si? That was your motion was to do all of them?
Yeah.
Are we considering paring that list down, or are we going to stick with the motion that's been seconded?
I am in favor of leaving it alone.
Okay.
That's what I would agree with what Bob said, and that is that, you know, we have very excellent reviewers who have done a good job tonight, and some of these issues, we should retain them and continue to do that, work with the same people. I'll leave that to the town.
Mm-hmm.
We need to get as much input as we possibly can for these people to act upon. There needs to be an independent input back to them. And I say, get on with it.
And I think, too, there's a hesitancy that comes with waiting till May 12th to find out that we need it to be done.
Yeah, I mean, we're just putting off these things. Just means we're consuming time. And time is of the essence, in my opinion. 180 days is going to come awfully fast.
And we need to know what the project is.
Right.
It is what's been put forth right now.
It is what's been laid on
it
the table.
It is what's in front of us right now, John. They've agreed that they may want to make some changes. We don't know what those changes are, but what we're asked to grant the permit on right now is 77 units.
Right. Now, I would hope if we voted for all of these or any of these tonight, said yes to the town, we give them authorization to go ahead on those, that the town, knowing the position they're in, they just wouldn't hand off what we have right now to somebody and say, go to it, knowing that there's going to be modifications made to this. I would think they would, you know, pull off.
Yes, I guess I'm the eternal optimist in many ways, and I would assume that we have a group of people here who want to develop something that's going to fly, because otherwise you're spending money going down the sewer because it's not going to fly unless you take it back to mass housing. And we don't want to go back. Personally, I don't want to go back to mass housing or have a decision by the board go back to mass housing and have mass housing tear us apart and tell us we'll give you 1.5%, 150% of what you asked for. We want something that the town can live with, and I'm assuming that if you want to do something, the town definitely wants to do something with that parcel. It's going to be a residential parcel. We've got to, our decision, the board's decision on the 40B, it's got to be based upon the residential project, or come to an agreement that you guys don't want to do it and the town doesn't want to do it. But the bottom line is that you're going to work together. Mm. If that's wrong, then we're sitting here wasting time. Your time, your money, and our time. So I don't know.
But it sounds to me as if even if there was authorization tonight to go forward on a lot of on these additional peer studies, that we would be prudent to wait until we see what comes forth the 1st of May.
I would think.
At the next meeting.
And so, maybe let me make a suggestion.
Yes.
The peer review consultants that were retained turned around their work product really quickly. And it seems as though if we add a time sensitive, maybe amend the motion to say that we'll, you know, if we authorize this entire list, we won't engage should the applicant come back with a reduction in units perhaps, or a modified design in X amount of weeks. We'll wait until that deadline passes and then go ahead and order the study on the 77. Does that make any sense to the town?
I'm very concerned about the water and sewer capacity. I don't know.
Right, so
I don't know the answer to that question.
Well, okay, so right, yeah, so you're speaking for the town, Gene, okay. And you're very concerned about that. We have the civil engineer's already been employed for that, so that's something.
Yes, ma'am. I think the water and sewer is a relevant question, no matter what. If you did five houses there or whatever, you think,
yeah.
And we're more than happy to get the ball rolling. I mean, we want to make sure it's done right. So that's something we're working on now. So we're more than happy to start that, because if it works at 77, it works at less than 77. So
right.
That's the process. If we could work with the peer review consultant that and figure out what the best way to get that information. I think that's good to start now, because we're working on it now. So we might. I think that let's get going on that. Mm-hmm. And some of these we'll provide you with the phase one. If you don't have it already, we'll send it in tomorrow to you guys. We have it on CD.
We'll close.
Paid a lot of money for it.
Close on Friday.
Oh, we'll send it on Monday. We have it on CD, so we can just give you. We could just drop off the CD for you. We have
sure.
The CD. It's two volumes.
Okay.
And some of these others, I think as we work with the peer review consultants, they're almost, some of them are part of their scope already to determine. And,
right.
And so I some think of there'll be some disagreement on some of them, meeting. But we want to work with you guys. So I think as we make changes, some of those change. But some of the big ones, water and sewer is what it is, no matter what we do there. So.
Okay.
More than happy to get going on
that. If I could add 2 cents to that, the DNI, every town has hotspots where there's inflow and infiltration. The engineering department knows where they are. It's just identifying where we're putting in our 11,660 gallons per day right now, proposed, and identifying an area that we can correct that would, you know, take that flow out. So you can get it in. It's not that difficult. So.
So it sounds okay. like we'd have to withdraw the motion and
amend it.
Gene
has a comment.
Yes, Gene.
So when Redding Woods came in, the engineering department had to take a look at whether or not our existing sewer pump station could handle that flow. And that took months and months and months to figure that out. And at the end, the determination was that it could not handle it. And that's where we ended up with Redding Woods. And we had to condition the approval of that development on either them making the needed improvements to that sewer pump station or building their own. And in this case, they built their own. It's a very complex area that we want to make sure we get right. I don't know the answer. I don't know if we have the proper pump station, piping. I don't know. And I think something we ought to know. It's my own thing.
Right. So I think if we start on that one immediately, Gene, we may have an answer. And if not, by the time the comprehensive permit is being prepared or something, it can be a condition then. It will be conditioned at that point that the capacity must be such that it can accept the additional flows.
Well, then procedurally, what we need to do is to take a vote.
Okay,
on the
so what we need is side to take that motion off.
I'll withdraw my second.
Withdraw your second.
You want me to withdraw? I'll withdraw the motion then.
You withdraw the motion, and then I will
accept
it.
A new motion can be made.
A new motion then, and it looks like we're looking at we're just looking at one additional study now.
At this point.
At this point. The others can be put off, and the applicant has noted that he has done the phase one environmental study, and that will be delivered to the town on Monday. So,
okay.
Yeah. So if you would like to revise your motion as such, Si?
Well, we're eliminating that one.
No. What we're going to do is
make
only
note
have
of it.
One of them.
Huh?
We're only moving forward on one. That's the, yes.
Yeah.
And which one are we talking about?
Water, the sewer.
The sewer and the water.
Sewer capacity.
Water and sewer capacity.
Third one down, Si?
And we've eliminated the other ones because? I know, I understand.
No, we haven't eliminated. We will withhold until further day. Until further day. Yeah, until a further day if needed, if we see the need.
Because at some point we're going to need that.
Yes.
Okay, I would move to authorize the town to fund additional peer review for the water and sewer capacity study.
Okay.
Do you want to add using our current consultant or our peer review consultant?
Absolutely, using our current peer review consultant.
Which makes it quicker and faster.
Sure.
And that I think Gene is okay with.
To be paid for by the applicant?
Yeah, the 53G account.
Yeah,
yes.
The 53G account.
Because right now we don't have anything in that account balance. There's no extra that we can go into. We'll have to ask them for the additional funds.
Well, I think that what they're motioning is they need it as much as we do.
Yep.
They're going to need it, so they're going to have to fund the account again.
And and you can work it out, I would hope.
So you
want Judy Mitch can handle that.
A friendly amendment that that the cost for the study will be funded out of the 53G account.
I would think so. There. Yep. I would think.
Okay. So we kind of understand the motion then, right? Do we understand the motion?
Okay. Do we have that? The water and sewer study, right, Si?
Yes.
And
I don't know. 53G account.
Using our present peer review specialist.
Civil engineer. Yeah. Right.
I can second that motion.
Seconded here. All those in favor? Okay, let the record show unanimous.
Okay. I don't think, well, we have some minutes. So I know we had minutes from the last meeting. Oh, yeah, that's the other, exactly, we want to reschedule, I forgot that. We can discuss that now, and I think we discussed May 12th was the next meeting would work for you.
Yeah, no, I have one quick comment that I hope it did not come across that we're not trying to cooperate with the town. We want, some of these studies are more important to us.
Yeah.
Like that one there, I mean, things have to get done right. So we just want to make sure we do things right with the resources this town have in the proper manner. So we're more than, you know, willing to figure out what that is as we move forward with that. So May 9th, is that
12th?
May 12th.
May 12th, so.
Yeah, I mean,
we'll
give
it
number. I think that's fine. We'll be ready for that.
Okay, so Julie's
going to
send them a memo.
Sorry.
Julie's going to send them a memo that the next meeting is on the 12th, right?
May 12th.
May 12th.
Yeah, who am I sending the memo to? The world?
Everybody.
Everybody.
And do we want to?
Okay, why don't we do a motion on this? I will take a motion for a continuation of the meeting to May 12th, 2016. So moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you. No public comment. No. Public. Next meeting, okay? Keep it up. You know, keep your question for the next meeting. Well, I don't know what to tell you. The public portion's closed. You just heard what we have for the next meeting is May 12th.
Right. So the issue is related to, since the time is so much longer than what they were requiring, that they have extra weeks, could we get the materials ahead of time? If they be posted to the website, we have time to review them?
They will be posted when they send them in. That's all I can tell you, yeah. That's what the town does, generally.
The information
for this meeting was
posted very far in advance.
So. Okay. We do have some minutes. Do you want to put those links to the next meeting we have, or do we want to handle that tonight? I went through them. This will be the February 4th meeting. I have no change.
Well, our next piece of regular meeting.
Yeah, so I would say if we can do it tonight, does anybody have any on this?
I know. February 4th?
February 18th.
February 18th.
The 18th.
Back to back.
Yeah.
I don't have any comments on the 4th.
I don't have any comments on the 4th. The 18th, I really it doesn't look like you like it at all.
Yeah, I think that didn't we already accept the
Excuse me. Can you carry your conversations outside? Thank you.
Didn't we hear the at our 53G when we talked about the 53G? I think I've already corrected.
I don't think we voted on them. I think perhaps we got to vote on them.
We did?
We voted.
That's all right.
On the fourth, we did it.
The 18th was the last meeting we had, was it not?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How could we vote on the minutes of that meeting if we haven't had a meeting since?
Hold on. Great. Write it
on
the back side of the February 18th meeting. We approved the minutes of February 4th.
Okay, so February 4th is done.
Yeah.
There you go. So, okay, it's February 18th then is what we have for the meeting.
I think the issue with the February 4th was there were some additional edits that Julie had made. And Maureen didn't inadvertently gave me the wrong version.
Yeah, so just vote on the new version.
The new version would cover it.
So we need to vote on
how do we? No, okay. How proceed?
So do we need to vote on them again, or?
Yes. Yeah, so my understanding is that I made edits, and she emailed them my edits to you, and so you saw them. But then the minutes that she actually gave you to vote on were the older version.
Yeah.
That's my understanding.
And there's, I mean,
we did approve them as amended.
Okay,
but we didn't have the amendment at the time.
You're saying,
yeah.
There.
And there would be no way to differentiate this and that one. These don't say, you know, revised minutes or anything. So I think, yeah, we had approved them as amended. So
okay.
Yeah.
I make a motion that we approve the minutes of February 18th, 2016.
I'll second that. I have a second. I have a motion before I. Any further comment? All in favor of approving the minutes of 2/18/2016?
Okay,
thank you.
Yeah.
Approved.
You weren't here.
You can still vote on it. Okay. Motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn. I'll take a second.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, thank you. And you have the schedule for the next meeting. I believe it's the 1st of April 7th, is it now?
Something like that.
Yeah, something like that. Anyway,
yeah,
that. Oh.
We need another binder, jeans.
Okay.
We don't have a binder.